Welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
Phone number 866-901-ADAM, 866-901-ADAM. Teresa Strasser over there. Dave Damashek over there. Wearing a San Jose Shark shirt.
Choo-choo.
I understand. My wife, not a huge fan of the Choo-choo Tamu songs.
She's
yes.
over it?
Well, she's very pregnant. You know, who knows with the circulating estrogen in her body? She may just not know what she's saying, you know?
I hope so. That doesn't sound like her. I thought she was a fan.
Does that mean Choo-choo and Tamu are out of the question for baby names?
No. They're still in the running.
Quite the contrary.
Yes. Yeah, she explained to me yesterday at dinner that she wasn't... By the way, dinner was me cooking what was left of some asparagus I found in a bag at the bottom of the thing and having the rest of some Zanku chicken that Ozzy brought over on Friday. Hmm. But that's my dinner. She was explaining to me that she'd had an ass full of it. But credits you with how say you. She'll do that. She'll go, how say you, every once in a while.
Yeah.
I love it when Damashek does his how say you. I says, well, I said that first, you know. No, I don't know. I disagree. She argues with me. She disagrees with that.
Well, that's her opinion. You have your opinion. How say you, fish tank?
Yeah.
Oh, sounds like they're on my side.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Dog pound was in full effect last night at the Idol, and it always makes me think of your fish tank. And yes, I agree. When someone like Randy Jackson does that, I get on Paula quite a bit because she's sort of incoherent and not nearly as likable as Randy Jackson. But Randy Jackson, between his calling 19-year-old girls dude and basically just saying it was aight or I'm not feeling it or hey, dog pound, what a life.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not even sure what his first language is, but it must be great to have about five catchphrases. This is all you want in life. It's all you want out of life. You want about five catchphrases. For me, I'm bringing back Shazbot because it's been 25 years, so
what
I can claim
mean?
It. That's, Robin Williams would say that in Mork and Mindy when he was upset about Shazbot. I think it was... sort of like BS. It was Morkin for BS from Orkin or wherever he's from. Orkin.
That's a good one. You're off to a good start.
That's all I got so far. Oh, and I don't know about that. That's the other one I got. And it takes all kinds.
What about go for it?
Go for it. I might throw in there. But I give Paul a lot of crap because she gets $5-6 million a year. And again, when I say year, it's like how school teachers get paid. They always complain they make $65K a year. They don't work. They only work 3/4 of the year. There's 3 months out of the year. So it's the same as them making $90K a year. In my book, she's making $5-6 million a year, not working 7-8 months out of the year, working 4-5 months out of the year, and then just sitting there going, yeah, I don't know. You have a nice dress. But Randy's even worse. Randy's like, yeah, dog, I don't know, dude. I mean, really? I would like to make a 7-hour reel of Randy going, just doing this. I don't know, dude. I wasn't feeling it, dude. It's all right. It's just all right. What? It's just all right. It's a little pitchy. It's all right. As specific as he gets is it was a little pitchy. And I like, think about something that you're an expert in. Teresa, Hebrew studies.
Right. Literature.
Okay, there you go. Dave, rotisserie, baseball.
Right.
For me, Star Wars trilogy. For me, maybe it'd be carpentry. You know, and if somebody was up there and they were doing rotisserie baseball picks and they took this guy over that guy or that guy over this guy, you wouldn't sit there and go, yeah, I don't know. I'm not sure. You'd go, this guy hit .366 with a slugging percentage of over .500 last year, and his on-base percentage was, how could you give him away for essentially a platoon player, a guy who didn't even, you know what I mean? You wouldn't just go like, ah, dog.
Of course, but you made the comparison earlier of Paula to school teachers. That's exactly right. As they say of teachers, those who can do, those who can't teach. These are essentially teachers. Paula Abdul is the worst singer in the history of the world. She's up there reviewing semi-talented people. These people aren't exactly talented themselves, but better than her.
I told my wife, look, if she was Ella Fitzgerald or some legendary singer, some national treasure with pipes, you know, she could get away with, like, you know, if she was Ella Fitzgerald or Dionne Warwick or something, she could go, well, I don't know, and get away with it just because she was that good. Just like a guy who hits 700 home runs can get away with analysis that's a little shaky. She was a horrible singer. She needs to be back to the sports equivalent. If she's going to go up to the booth and she's a bullpen catcher, she better be sharp and she better be fast. She's no legend.
Yeah.
She's not going to the Hall of Fame. She better be good. And the fact that she just sits there and goes, last night she even turned back to Randy. She said, nice dress. Looks good on you, good color. And then she turned back to Randy. It's like, could you finish my sentence for me? And Randy was like, hey, dog, I used up my dog and my pound, and I wasn't feeling it.
Randy does have another trick up his sleeve, and that is that he has the extra added strain of having to work in as often as possible that he was a member of Journey.
Yes, it's got to be rough.
And by the way, obviously his ability to think rationally is in question because he chooses to be a modern day black man version of Sally Jesse Raphael. What is with those
crazy glasses?
Blue shades.
Listen,
that's awfully weird.
Here's the deal when it comes to eyewear.
Yes.
You know, I've said when you're black, you can wear whatever hat you want.
Right.
No one ever questioned him.
Right.
When you're heavy set, you can wear whatever frames you want on your glasses. And when you're black and heavy set, the world is your frame oyster. You can wear anything you want. There's no heavy
set. You wear oyster shells as glasses.
No, that's what I'm literally saying. You wear, world shaped, globe shaped oysters on your head. The world is your oyster. That's the whole thing. Fat people can wear any glasses they want. And also, fat people have more leeway with hats. Too, not nearly as much as blacks. 120-pound black guy still trumps a 500-pound white guy in the hat department. Still whatever hat he wants. But as the fatter you get, the cooler hat you get to wear. And when you get heavy set, especially white female in her 50s, you wear any frames you want. That's it.
Tad's excited about his hat.
Yes.
By the way, can I
say
to you,
Tad's got a lot of hat and frame potential, by the way.
While you were eating your cold asparagus, I was dining on Miss Cindy's Portuguese-style sea bass.
Is that what she calls her private parts?
Yes.
That is involved.
Yes, but it was a wild night. Listen, yes. She's made many concoctions in her kitchen. I rate this perhaps at the top of the list.
Yeah.
Portuguese-style
sea bass
is divine.
Is great. Yeah.
You'd pay 30-some-odd bucks in some fancy joint for this.
Sea bass is, for my money, the best fish you get at the restaurant.
I know. I traveled across the Atlantic to Portuguese land.
Mm. Yeah, no.
Portugal, I think they call it over there.
Yeah.
It's early.
And I,
no, that's,
without leaving my couch, it was delivered to me. It was
the
delicious.
Things you love about the sea bass are the things you hate about Big Tad. White and flaky. Thank you. Bill?
Yeah.
What's happening?
Hey, Hey, Adam, just to let you know, I really dig on your show, dude.
Thank you, dude.
Yeah, you guys are cool.
Yeah.
Hey, check this out. I knew you'd have an answer for this. I have an employee that has this really bad odor.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
How do you tell an employee that they stink?
It's a male.
It's a female.
Uh-oh. Ooh. Is it like a body odor or a bad perfume?
It is. No, it's a bad odor. Like it's a
Chilean sea bass?
It probably smells like Dave Sea Bass.
Yeah.
It's all a right. bad smell. I mean, it's a BO odor. You know what I mean? I'm trying to figure out how do you tell the person.
I understand. It's tough. It can really be tough. And I would have difficulty saying anything as well. I will tell you something I decided on or came up with when we used to do Loveline many years ago. And I'll tell you, I think it would work. Now, it's a little bit of a stretch being in your position. Once in a while, guys would call and say, my lady's bassy area has a funky smell to it. And I don't know what to say. I mean, it's going to crush her if I say anything. It'll freak her out. She'll never want to have sex again, or she'll dump me, or it's going to be humiliating. I said, you know what? Here's what you should do. You should say that you were driving along, listening to Loveline. You heard somebody else call in and talk about this. Maybe a woman call in and talk about this. And Dr. Drew seemed concerned. He said that could be an infection. Now, seriously, what you're smelling, when things go a little south in that area or any area, you can be smelling, you know, things have their smells. And that's one of the ways you know things have gone bad. So he seemed concerned for her health. So, baby, because I love you so much, I notice a little something. I'm wondering if you have an infection, you should get yourself checked out. That, if you said you heard a doctor talking about scents coming from people, and you know, here's the other thing, too. Say you just noticed it. Don't say, we've all been living with this shame for the last 5 years. Right. You say, I just noticed this. I heard this thing on CNN, how whatever. I wonder, you know, I care about you. I wonder if you might have an infection or something. Maybe you should get a physical, get checked out. Maybe you have something going on. That'll give the general note to the person. And meanwhile, you're coming from a place of concern, and you have to pretend like you just noticed it and just heard the story earlier that day. Well, your only angle.
Being told that you smell so bad that your coworkers are concerned that you're sick.
Heard a story. It's either that or just set off the fire. I'll do the thing where I hold the Bic lighter over the fire sprinklers. I'll just hold it until they go off in the building. That's the only thing I can do.
I put two air fresheners inside of her office, so I wonder if that's a little hint.
Wow. Probably is. All right, well, good times there, Bill.
Hey, good times, Adam. You know what, bro? I'm telling you, your show makes me laugh every morning, man. You guys are all funny. I love you. You guys are great.
Well, thanks.
Right on. Great show.
Appreciate it. Nice to hear at this young hour. Speaking of young Christian.
Oh.
How you guys doing?
Christian the comedian. What's happening, my friend?
Not much. How about you?
Doing good. Well, last time we saw Christian was a week ago.
Right.
Tonight. Was leaving in his after his triumphant appearance over at the Improv. How's the last week been for you?
It's been pretty good.
It's a new life or no?
Yeah. Everyone, a lot of people, like one of my teachers came to the show and I guess she told everyone, so everyone found out about the thing.
Really?
Congratulating me and stuff.
Yeah. Christian, our 13-year-old comedian who had his debut last week at the Improv, as they says, he slaughtered. He killed. Yeah. People went wild. A standing ovation finished his 10-minute set.
Now he's the king of his middle school. I heard him yell at some kid he wanted to freschen up on his chocolate milk. Mock Schnell. Kid was running to the cafeteria.
Been banging groupies last week.
Yeah. So, let's see. 13, does that put you in the 7th grade? 8th grade?
I'll be in 9th grade in a couple of weeks.
Ninth grade in a couple of weeks. And ninth grade means high school now, right?
Yeah.
Is that pretty much everywhere?
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
It's everywhere now.
Ninth grade, yeah.
High school. Didn't used to be that way.
Really?
No. Although it varied from state to state, and I wonder if it still does, but probably not, because California, where I went to high school started in the 10th grade.
Really?
Junior high, 7.
You always had to have freshman, sophomore, junior, senior. No.
No, that's why it was always confusing whether you were a freshman or a sophomore when you're in the 10th grade, because in fact it was your first year, but in fact then what happened to sophomore? Point is, I didn't need all that college talk anywhere. Well, anyway, I was heading to clean carpets in Van Nuys, but the point is they then changed it at some point where you then went to high school in the 9th grade, which I think is a horrible plan, because here's how high school works. Anyone who you go to school with, it's open humping season on. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I mean, there are guys who are in my high school, in every high school, especially out here in the San Fernando Valley. There are guys that are 18 years old, sometimes older than 18 years old. They have mustaches and tattoos. There are a fresh crop of 14 and 15-year-old girls being funneled into the school. And it's fair game. Yeah, I'm dating some from my high school. Mm-hmm. Right, she's 14, you're 19. you're a three-time loser and you drive a beat-up Ranchero, she still has her hymen, but you guys are going out.
You obscure these lines with titles, though, it doesn't happen as much as what you're saying.
Right. I'm saying 10th graders and seniors is a little bit of a stretch. When a girl is 15 or 16 going out with a 17 or 18-year-old guy, that's a pretty big gap. When you drop down to 9th grade, now it's really pushing the boundaries. I don't think it's a great plan to throw the 9th grade girls in with the senior dudes. I'll bet way more than one 9th grade girl has been deflowered by some debaucherous senior dude. And again, it's just who are you dating? Someone from my high school. I'm on the football team. She's a cheerleader, whatever. I don't think it's a great plan.
Seems kosher. Meanwhile, the guy's got a car. He's buying you wine coolers.
Right. A huge difference between a senior in high school and a 9th grader, especially young Christian. I'm sorry. Anyway, Christian.
That's all right.
Where were we?
We were just,
yeah, see?
I don't know.
Next thing we have to work on is when he does the talk show circuit.
Yeah.
Right. And he gets called over to the sofa.
The banter.
He needs an anecdote at the ready.
Yeah, anecdote at the ready. That's right. All right, Christian, do you have some new comedy for us this morning?
I do.
All right.
I've decided that over 50% of the suicidal population work at Disneyland. Mm. I'll tell you why.
Mm-hmm.
I want you to picture yourself on a Saturday waking up at 7 in the morning and going to work only to wear a giant, hot, heavy suit of an oversized talking animal and taking pictures with hundreds of thousands of toddlers every day.
Yeah.
You hear that and a gun barrel to the head doesn't seem so bad. But I think the people in the suits have it easy because they don't have to smile all day long. Those poor waitresses and ride operators have to do it all the time.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you a story. I was in the line for Splash Mountain for 2 hours, and when I got in front, these three people came out of a special line and got in front of me, and I asked the ride operator, so why'd they get in front? He said, well, they're single riders, sir. I said, what does that mean? Well, they're riding alone. I was riding alone, and I waited in line, so I thought maybe when I get off the ride, I'll come back. So I went on the ride. I came back. I say, I'm a single rider. Can I go in front? He said, you need a pass, sir. I said, where do I get a pass? He says, from me, sir. Can I have one? He hands me a pass. I hand it back to him. He said, it needs to be signed by a parent or guardian, sir. I said, you let me go 5 minutes ago without a signature. He said, you weren't using a pass that time, sir. So we were just arguing over this pass thing, and I can tell he's trying to keep a straight face while I explode, and I finally got over it. And when I got home, I actually saw that guy on the 6 o'clock news. He had committed suicide.
Wow. Yeah.
Setup might be a little long on that one.
Yeah, but I was sort of interested in how the pass and the single rider
this
thing
is
worked.
Up your alley, Carolla, dealing with people like this who have limited power in the world, so they lord it over you.
Yes.
You need that pass. Well, where do you get it? From me. Then they give it to him.
Sir, once you enter the theater, I can't let you out of the theater. Yes. Do you see the red Hyundai? Do you see it? I'm just going to go over there and get my jacket. I'm sorry, sir. Once you leave the theater, I can't let you back in. You can watch me walk to the car and get my sweat jacket. I'm sorry, sir. Once you leave the theater. All right. Nice work as usual, Christian.
Thank you.
I'll tell you, I went along with him on the journey, the line, the Space Mountain run. It was almost as long as the actual wait at Space Mountain. But I went with him on that journey, and I appreciate the fact that he now has the newfound confidence to sort of expand a little bit, to get a little more conversational, tell a story. It's nice because when you first start doing stand-up, you just think, joke, 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 joke. I have to rapid fire jokes. I must be a Gatling gun of jokes. And then you get more comfortable and you get up there and you start talking about stories and personal stories and Chilean sea bass and things like that. That's good that at age 13 he's already getting comfortable
Like Cosby.
Right.
He does that.
Mm-hmm.
I, conversely, I've mastered it the other way. I can do the long-winded, long stories and stuff. I haven't figured out the joke part yet.
Right. Usually, if it doesn't come by your 35th birthday, Dave, it doesn't come.
I'm keeping my chin up.
All right.
Fingers crossed.
All right. We'll take ourselves a quick break. We're going to play What Can't Adam Complain About when we come back. So, I can complain about anything. You just tee it up for me, and I will hit it out of the park. Now, again, these can be topics that people can't normally complain about. Oxygen, dolphins, things like that. I figure I can find the gray streak and any silver lining, or the black cloud over any silver lining, or wherever it goes, I can turn a rainbow.
The world champion of complainers.
Yeah.
You've complained about, as you say, rainbows, teddy bears, big boobs,
Dolphins,
beer.
Anything. Right. So you call up, give me a topic, spit it out, and I will spit out a complaint. Also, Kristen Dolce, she's on the cover of Playboy. She's
Bobby. Coming in.
Also, Kane, 7-foot wrestler, known as the Big Red Monster. New sports. Dave has a jerk report. We're giving away another Gibson guitar, so we'll have some playing and some riffs and some contest stuff for that. Also, Doug, our Indian intern, is going to do his Hollywood happenings today. All that still to go.
Last Friday, with $1,000 on the line.
How do I sign off each show?
Mahalo.
Mo Damashek, you are the queen of all moms.
But then, an unexpected twist.
Mo has generously not accepted the $1,000.
No.
It will roll over in the kitty and be worth $2,000 next week.
So that means this Friday, someone's going to walk away with $2,000. And all you got to do to win is beat Dave's mom. Will someone win the cash? Or will Mo Damashek get another chance to feed the kitty? Find out Friday on the app.
What can Adam complain about? As it turns out, I can complain about anything.
Can you complain about a whorehouse?
All right. And then I'll do the next on your speech impediment. Sounds a lot like warehouse, but never have two houses been further apart.
A TiVo.
I don't like the creepy TiVo mascot. What is he? We're not retarded children.
How about breastfeeding mothers?
The kid is actually doing something you did on your second date to your wife while you try to watch TV. Give me the bottle. I mean a bottle with booze in it. Wow. I kind of like this bell. You know what I like?
Complain about that bell.
Once in a while, when somebody dies in boxing, some legendary trainer or something, they do the moment of silence with the 10 rings.
Not as stirring as the 21 gun salute.
No, but it's funny. It's like some black guy, legendary trainer from the 30s. Had 1,500 amateur fights and 2,000 pro fights. Mm-hmm. Died. Ended up his final record was 1,800 wins, 236 losses. Used to fight four times a week.
Sweet P. McCoy.
That's right. Back when they had horse hair in the gloves. Everyone has to be quiet. All right, where are we? Yes, we're playing What Can Adam Complain About? You call in, you throw out the topic, I mow through them. I don't know what they are. We've not spoken.
Before it commences, yes, this needs to be accentuated at this point. You're not privy to what these calls are. Mm-hmm. This will be off-the-cuff complaining. It's remarkable feat that you can do this about any subject in the world.
Thank you. Some better than others. They're not all home runs. But the point is we don't get interns to hop on phones and load them up with topics I feel passionate about.
Correct.
All right. That's a little Ass Kiss Rodeo, wasn't it? Here we go.
Sorry, Brian. The world is full of it. And one man has a complaint for it all. This is What Can't Adam Complain About?
All right, let's get started. Eric, topic, please.
Hello?
Yeah! Topic.
I don't think you can complain about getting a Hummer from a beautiful woman.
Yes, I can. What about, I was watching some pornography just the other night, and I saw the beautiful buxom lady giving the BJ to the stunt penis, and she did that thing where she started rubbing the guy's thigh, and I thought, now fake. No one is that much into it. I didn't like it. If you're doing that to a guy, I want your hands behind your back and folded in those little zip ties that the cops round you up in. I don't want any thigh rubbing, any nad play. Any talk, any gum chewing, anything else. I like a pure Hummer. And as far as a beautiful woman goes, what would my wife say if she caught us? Thank you. Who's next? Jeff?
Hey, how's it going, Adam?
Good topic, please.
All right, here's the topic. If you tell me a complaint about this, that's just Chazbot, all right?
All right.
here's what we got. Beautiful, large-breasted women, scantily clad, bouncing on trampolines.
I'll tell you, if I wasn't involved with the man show, I'd have nothing to complain about. But to me, it's like going to work now. When I see a trampoline or a beautiful woman or a busty woman or a scantily clad woman on a trampoline, to me, it's like working at Baskin-Robbins and trying to enjoy ice cream over the weekend. It's now I equate it with work. I equate boobies with work. I equate booze with work. I equate trampolines with work. I equate complaining with work. Everything is work now. Thank you. I've ruined it for myself. Nick, topic, please. Uh-oh, I locked it. Nick? Well, he's there. Nick, do you have a topic? All right, let's move on. Steve?
Yes?
Topic, please.
John Entwistle's bass playing on The Real Me.
Well, great song. Great Who song. John Entwistle, one of the greatest bass songs ever. He's dead, number one, so it makes me think of dead people when I hear that song. The other thing is there's 1,000 bad Who songs and 5 good Who songs. They only play the 1,000 bad ones on the commercials and on the radio. What is wrong with goddamn music radio that they can take a great band, pick out their 3 worst songs, and then repeat them over and over and over again, and rarely do you ever get to hear the good songs? Oh, every once in a while, 4 a.m. on a Sunday night when they're doing deep cuts, or they're playing the full record album length, or they're playing the second side, or they're playing the whatever, then you get to hear the good stuff. Why do they do this? And furthermore, stop the audience testing, because you know what these crappy radio stations do? They get a group of guys like Big Tad in a room, okay? Because those are the only guys who put up with audience testing, because they're the only people that are free in the middle of the week, in the middle of the goddamn day, and will do something for a fun bag of Doritos. So they sit them down and they go, hey, let's listen to this song. And people go, oh, yeah, that song. Yeah, I know that song. And it tests very well because they know the song. And we have to hear Bob O'Reilly again, which, by the way, should just be changed to Teenage Wasteland. They don't mention Bob O'Reilly anywhere in this song. And then you're one of these a-holes that seems like an idiot when you go, hey, I like that Bob O'Reilly song, or what's it called, the Won't Get Fooled Again song, or the Teenage Wasteland song, and then some a-hole has to correct you. I'm going to listen to this entire 9-minute song, and if they say Baba O'Reilly one time in this song, I will give everyone $10,000.
But you're cool.
Hold on. We're listening. Don't worry. In a short 7 minutes, they start singing.
Got nothing but time.
Now,
who is Baba O'Reilly anyway?
That's my point. If this song was called Out Here in the Fields, Teenage Wasteland, or Teenage Wasteland, I would definitely go for it. But Bob O'Reilly, who are they kidding? They're no Led Zeppelin. Where are we? Ray?
Yes, I think you can't complain about frozen burritos.
I can complain about frozen burritos. I'll tell you why. First off, you can never heat them correctly. They can be molten on the right side and still frozen on the left side. They can still have a frozen core and a molten outer jacket. Always tough to figure out, and you never fully get to the bottom of it until you're down the road in your car. You do that thing where you go to the 7-Eleven, you go to the microwave, you turn it to the picture of the corn dog, you turn it to the picture. By the way, I don't like being chastised by the microwave. I don't need to see a picture of a corn dog. Just say 33 seconds or whatever it takes in the thing. Turn it to the picture of the burrito. And by the way, that's how you know your life isn't going well. When you're exposed to microwaves that have pictures of frozen food on it, and you have to just turn the handle to the corresponding frozen food. But you do it, and then you grab it, and you can barely pick it up. Ah! Oh, wow, wow! And then you get in your car, and you start driving away, and you realize there's a popsicle in the center of my burrito. A bean popsicle. Thank you. Other than that, no beefs. Pardon the pun. Mike?
Hey, Adam.
Yes.
Second time caller. Listen, I don't think you can complain about...
No second time callers on this program. Only virgins. It's hymen popping time. It's finger popping and hymen popping time. Thank you. Laura?
Hey, Adam.
Mm-hmm.
You can't complain about smoked almonds.
I'll tell you, yes, I can complain about smoked almonds. I'll tell you why. I love smoked almonds, but they're too smoky. They put too much of the smoky powder on them, and they're too salty. Do you guys realize that almost every snack has about 40% too much sodium? The peanuts, the nuts, the chips, the crackers, they leave a nice big trail. Go grab yourself a handful of smoked almonds. If you buy them in the big chub pack like I do, and you reach your hand into that kitty and you walk over to watch some TV, when you're done, your hand will smell like Ozzy's barbecue, which essentially, I assume, smells like Ozzy's apartment, which smells like his wife, which smells like his kids, which smells like his car, which smells like his soul. Point is your hand will smell of smoky goodness. Here, let me paint you a scenario. You eat a handful of smoked almonds. You don't wash your hands. Now you go out to the mailbox to collect the mail. You're standing out in the street. Giant bear attacks you, thinking you smell like a brisket steak. Sorry, brisket. Do you know what I'm saying? Did I call him brisket? I like that.
You're on a roll.
I'm on a roll. Let's change his name from brisket to brisket to brisket. Sounds like the world's yummiest gun. All right. Too much salt, too much smoky flavor. I wash them. I actually grab a handful of smoked almonds and wash them under the sink to knock off some of that salt. I don't know if it's a preservative. I don't know if they have some sort of covert deal with the beverage company to get you to drink more diet soda or consume more beer. Point is, too much salt, too much sodium. And by the way, they put salt on stuff like it's good for you. It's bad for you. They should be using as little of it as possible. Whatever it takes to get away with still tasting nummy is what they should use. They use twice as much. They're trying to kill America. Last one. Eric.
Adam.
Go ahead, my brother.
How can you complain about illegal aliens?
do an hour. But here's the reality. We've talked about it on this show. I have nothing against my Mexican brethren. That's all I've worked with over the years. And growing up in the San Fernando Valley, well, there you go, San Fernando. There's not a place in this town that doesn't have a Spanish surname. But here's...
Huntington.
Here, okay, one place. And there you got a bunch of Heshers who have ear infections from floating in a polluted ocean for 9 hours a day. But look, here's the deal. Dave has a beloved sport called rotisserie baseball. Oh, yes, it's a sport. If curling and bowling can be a sport, then why can't rotisserie baseball be a sport? Here's my point. When he makes a team, he can't draft 9 first basemen. He needs a catcher, a pitcher, a third baseman, outfielders. That's what this country needs. Right now, Los Angeles, where I live, has too many Mexicans. We're 50% Mexicans, which is like we have a rotisserie team with 18 center fielders and 22 first basemen. I want a pitcher. I want a catcher. I want a third baseman. I want to start trading people. I want to take some of our first basemen. Go trade them to Minnesota. Get ourselves a right fielder. I like the full team, and I like the different jobs that they do. Right now, we have too many of one. That's all I'm saying.
I'm with you.
Immigration, fine. We'll take 10 of you, 10 of you, 10 of you, and 10 of you. It's like going and buying bagels. I want 10 of these. I want 10 of the garlic. I want 10 of the sesame. I don't want 100 million of the same crappy one. Thank you very much. Powerful. Powerful stuff. Brisket. Yeah.
That was What Can't Adam Complain About?
I'll tell you, that really is you at the you know, in your prime.
Yeah.
You know? This is Ali in, against
Zaire.
Right, in Zaire.
Yeah, yes, the knockout punch top. To me was when you connected roasted almonds with a bear attack.
Yeah.
That was excellent.
Well, it's true. It's way, way too much of that salty, smoky, whatever spray they put on those things. Everything. You know, as I said before, all they're telling you to do in society is easy on the sodium, buddy.
Right.
Take it easy on the salt. It's not good for you. It raises your blood pressure, so on and so forth. And then you weigh that against saying, yeah, but you know what? It's so good. It makes everything taste better. I mean, if you have yourself some vegetables, you sprinkle a little salt on, all of a sudden they come to life. Why oversalt everything
to preserve
it if in fact it's bad for you? Does it preserve
it? Yeah, that's why they do that, so they can keep it on the shelves for 5 years.
I hear that, but everything's put in a vacuum packed whatever, and everything's filled with MSG anyway. Will the almonds go bad if they just had a normal amount of salt on them?
Yes, I have the raw almonds, and you got to keep them in the refrigerator.
Really?
Yes, they go bad.
All right, baby. You know, Maybe one day we could get my overly salted smoky almonds together with your plain and drab raw almonds and create some sort of almond paradise. You know
Magic.
What I mean?
Yeah.
I got what you need. I got a little more than what I need. You could use some of what I got. We'll work it out. All right, baby?
All right.
Raw almonds. What are you doing? Punishing yourself with that?
Yeah, it's just a form of self-hatred.
They are gross.
Yeah, the thing about raw almonds is when you don't cook stuff, when you don't bake it or roast it or broast it, and you don't dust it with copious amounts of salt, everything just tastes the same. Has anybody ever had, for instance, raw unsalted peanuts? Mm-hmm. They just taste like a squirrel chewed up an acorn and spat it in your mouth. You have no idea. All legumes just sort of fall under the same umbrella. They all become the same big bland, crappy nut. Okay. We'll take ourselves a little break. I gotta shut it off.
I'll take us out to prove to you that some of us respect the sanctity of good Who songs versus the ones that have been beaten into the ground. That's mm-hmm. how we'll go out
there. All right. A little something. Oh, no. No.
A little see me, feel me.
This will be playing in the delivery room, I think, right?
Hey, Moo.
Oh, here it comes.
There you go, see?
Cheat you, Tamu.
I thought working with Townsend is one of the great thrills of my life.
Cheat you, Tamu.
Yeah, he doesn't usually collaborate this much. I'm surprised you're able to sit down with him. I guess he respected you as a musician, an artist.
Yeah.
All right.
Enough of that.
We'll take a quick break, and we have Christine, Dolce. Oh, no, Pat O'Brien as well going to be on the show. Pat, B.O.B. from The Insider calling up. Talk to him after this.
So much show, and it's all coming up. Get down.
Going in, punching in, working for the man. But when Friday comes, you know I'm ready to party. Went home, punched out, got out of my dungarees, got into my nice duds, went out, fired up the Lincoln, took the lady out for the night. Whole schedule all the way through. You know what I mean? Now they just talk about smacking chicks and stuff, but they used to sing about their day.
Stick around. We'll be right back with more of the Adam Carolla Show. Adam Carolla Show. Here's what happened recently on The Insider with Pat O'Brien.
Amy Fisher, Mary Jo, and Joey Buttafuoco, and it gets ugly. Amy and Mary Jo's reunion goes from happy to horrible.
It was a reunion nobody ever saw coming.
Why?
Mary Jo Buttafuoco and Amy Fisher finally together, staring into each other's eyes. The silent, dramatic, tense standoff is 15 years in the making.
You're gonna burn in hell, you little f***.
He wasn't having sex with her. They were just good friends. He was 48. He owned an auto body place. She was 15. P.O.B. is on the line. Pat O'Brien. What's happening, Pat?
Now when I read those things, all I can think about is you.
Thank you.
And every little misspeak or sensationalized word I use. You know that bumper sticker? Good morning, by the way.
Good morning, Pat.
You know that bumper sticker, What Would Jesus Do?
Yes.
I want to make one, What Would Adam Do?
What would Adam complain about? Yeah. I like Pat. I'll tell you what Pat O'Brien would do. He would tell you what Jesus would do coming up in 22 minutes.
That's right. No, I can't tell you now. But coming up, that's in about 19 minutes.
Pat checks his watch, too. Coming up, 19 minutes, 30 seconds.
I ran into somebody the other day. What's his name? The $6 million man. What's that guy's name?
Steve Austin. Lee Majors.
Yeah, Lee Majors. He doesn't even say hi. He goes, how come it's always like 21 minutes? Why can't it be 24 or 18?
Look, why don't you use your...
What would Adam
yes,
do?
Yes.
Yesterday I went over to Tower Records on Sunset
mm-hmm.
to buy my Gnarls Barkley CD.
Sure.
And I walked right into a making of a video for White Star.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what would you do? I mean, you walk in, and there's all of a sudden three cameras on you. Cisco comes up, gives me a hug.
Uh-huh.
You know you're on TV, and they're giving you a release statement to sign. I'm trying to buy a CD.
Well, it's weird because if you're doing a video, you're obviously not counting on celebrity traffic coming in. I mean, you obviously just have to have patrons of the store, but then P.O.B. shows up staring at his watch and bumps into the camera.
Right.
Don't know what to do. So did they put you in the video?
I signed a release. It's a VH1 making of a video or a band or something. But
it would be smart.
All I was trying to do was buy a CD.
Yeah, it would be smart to put you in a video, because that way you would then premiere it on the Insider, right?
Well, I think I'm a lock because I did recognize Cisco, and I said, "Hey, Cisco, what's up?" That's got to be in there, right?
Pat is down with the kids because Pat, for some reason, cares about what his kid cares about. Somehow, my folks miss that boat. You know, Pat has young sons who are, I guess, 17, 18 now. How old is your son?
Almost 19 now, Adam.
Almost 19, and he wants to stay relevant with his son. So it's none of that 22 Skidoo business. We're listening to Les Brown and his band of renown. It's Who You Down With, boy. And then he invites them all to his party.
P.O.B.
Yes.
P.O.B., let me point some good news out to you. What would Adam do? You just suggested that as a bit. That was a bit on The Man Show that I wrote for Corolla. So you and I think alike.
Right.
Now, since that's the case, can I come to the Christmas party?
Nope.
No. Sorry. Even though you share that. I forgot I did that bit.
There's no reason, there's no logical way you will ever be invited to my Christmas. It doesn't mean I don't like it, right? Mm-hmm.
No. It's just you can't go unless you're willing to distribute shrimp puffs. If you're not going to carry food,
I'll think
you can't use you. Yes.
Here's the criteria. He doesn't have enough gravitas.
Right. Mm-hmm. Hollywood juice. Yep.
I agree. He has small testicles.
Not even Hollywood, because there are some very normal, you know.
Right. No, he has regular, interesting people there. They just have something we call it, and you're lacking it, Dave.
Dang.
Let's talk Da Vinci Code for 1 second, P.O.B., because I saw on, I guess it was The Insider, maybe it was just I was watching CNN early this morning, that the movie's getting panned.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Well, it's got some 4-star reviews in some papers, but apparently the people at Cannes didn't like it.
Interesting.
Oh, after all this, that would be a shocker. Huh?
Have you seen any of it? Have you
seen it tonight?
You're seeing it tonight.
It's a premiere tonight.
Ah, that'll be nice. Where is that tonight?
Screening tonight at the ArcLight.
Mm.
There's one in Westwood, I think, too. Mm. But it's kind of the media screening. I've seen chunks of it. I don't know how it can go wrong, to be honest with you. I mean, you got Tom Hanks, two-time Oscar winner and one of the biggest actors in the world. You got Ron Howard, who's unbelievably great director.
Right.
And Brian Grazer, the great producer. I mean, and the shot all over the world, interesting places.
Yeah. No, it's not going to go wrong. I think those people are just naysayers because it's been hyped so much for so long that you just have to say something. And if it's something good, well, you just join the crowd. Pat, I want to thank you for joining the show. Host of The Insider.
Your favorite TV show.
It absolutely is. Absolutely is. I'm ashamed to say it. I really am.
And The Insider, I hope, has some camera crew stationed outside the Corolla estate waiting for news of the baby births.
We've got to cover this big time.
Of course. Well,
according to my wife, it's already happened 9 times.
Right.
They're set to drop.
Yes.
Right. On the 7th of June. Now, they were going to drop on the 6th of June, but then that would have made the kids born on 666. And my wife, we're not religious people, but I've seen the billboards around town. Probably not a great plan. So we're going for 7 because they're going C-section. And when you go C-section, they take them when they want. I say take them after they graduate from high school. Let's save some problems.
Well, you know, they could have already been born. They could be 2 months old.
They could come out. The man could come out wearing a mustache wax, and the girl could be wearing Lee press-on nails, for all I know.
I don't think you want the birthday to be 666.
That's what I'm saying. So we either go 5 or we go 7. We're supposed to go 7, but the way it looks now, the kids have already dropped into the prone position. So that could happen any day.
Well, this is a huge event, and this will be high on my list, in sweeps or out.
Right.
All right. To cover.
Well, you shoehorn it in between Baby Bump News and Eva Longoria.
Brangelina.
Did another costume change at the Latin Grammys.
Well, I think it's bigger than those stories.
Thank you, Pat. Certainly on a personal level. All right. Pat O'Brien, host of The Insider. Check your local times. Thanks a lot, P.O.B. We'll take ourselves a quick break. We have a Christine Dolce. She's the most downloaded, or I don't know if it's downloaded, but she's the queen of MySpace, which I really know nothing about. I thought this was for civilians. I didn't know it was for celebrities. We'll figure this out. Either way, she's hot. We have news. We have sports. All coming up.
Can't get enough? Check out Adam on the web at adamcarolla.com.
I never got past high school math, so I'm not sure what pi is exactly, but any equation that involves dessert, I'm in for.
Adam will never run out of opinions. The Adam Carolla Show.
Hi, this is Stewie Griffin. Call Adam Carolla now at 1-866-901-ADAM.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now, up the queen of MySpace with over 900,000 friends. They can't be close friends. Christine Dolce is in studio.
Hello.
Nice to see you, sweetie.
Nice to see you, too.
Looking good.
Thank you.
Solid D cup. Beautiful blonde.
Yeah, perhaps the most robust bosom to ever sit within these four walls.
Yeah, next to Big Tad, safe Big Tad and Brusket over there. Sure. Yeah, lady bosom. Sure, yes. Certainly. How does this this get started? I know nothing about MySpace. I'm like a bad parent. I have no idea what goes on. I thought it was just teenagers trying to get sex off each other and the occasional pedophile. How does it work for you?
You know, I was actually one of the first members to join. Mm-hmm. I was about number 14,000 to join, and I believe there's about 70 million people now that are on MySpace. And, you know, I was just one of the first members to join, and, you know, my friend said, hey, come over to the MySpace, you know, site, and I joined. And
what can we find on your site? Pictures of you looking good, scantily clad, right?
You know, pictures and things that I have to say and, you know, just things that are going on in my
life. What do you have to say?
Yes.
What do I have to say?
Well, you do the Game Killers, right?
Yes.
Now, you talk about the guys or the girls that are running interference when single people are trying to get laid, essentially.
I actually, you know, I get dated, like, advice and emails all the time for my mm-hmm. profile, and I got approached by Axe. Mm-hmm. And it was a great opportunity for me to work with them as far as me being the group moderator for their Game Killers site on
Axe,
MySpace.
The body spray.
Yeah.
And so what are some of the things guys do to kill games or girls do to kill games? Who are the game killers? We were talking about this yesterday. And you tell me if you agree or disagree with this. When two guys go out and one guy hooks up, he has no problem telling his buddy, guess who doesn't need a ride home? Guess who is going to spend the night with somebody new? And again, I'll see you in the morning, buddy. Good luck to you. I'm on my own. Guys have no problems dumping their friends, even if they drove. Hey, find your way home, or here's $20. Call a shuttle. I'm out of here. Girls don't want to do that because they don't want to appear slutty to their other female friends. Exactly. Is that true?
Yeah, that's totally true.
How do you avoid that?
You know? Uh-oh. I didn't say that.
Ironic.
I think, Christine, the question is, if you're a guy and you're trying to get a girl away from her pack, how do you separate the girl from her friends and take her home?
What if you were in a group of your girlfriends? I wanted to take you home. You wanted to go with me. And I know this is a stretch, but you wanted to go home with me. How would I extricate you from your pack of friends? What would be the best technique?
To be confident and be real mm-hmm. and keep your cool.
But what does that do? What physically do I need to do? I show up to the group of friends. I see you. Hey, Christine, it's the Ace Man. You want to do my morning radio show? Well, you're going to have to speak into the mic at night. Do you know what I'm saying?
That's my line.
That's what I use with the ladies.
I can give you an example right now. You know, don't be that typical guy that's the one-upper that's mm-hmm. going to one-up you on everything that you say, you know? Anything you say, he one-ups you on.
How does that work?
I'm going to one-up you.
So, one-up me.
So I go in, and again, I'm confident. How do I get you away from your group? And will
be yourself.
Can you get away from your group and go spend the night with me? You can?
I don't know.
No, well, I don't mean me, but one.
Quit the buzzer.
Yeah.
Be real. Be confident. Uh-huh. Be yourself.
Uh-huh.
And be cool.
Yeah, that's never worked.
Oh,
the be myself part has never worked.
I never get that. What is be yourself? I need a constructive tip.
Be real.
If you're Lorenzo Lamas, be yourself. If you're everyone else, act like Lorenzo Lamas. That's that's what I'm going to tell my kid. Don't be yourself. Remember, you're a Corolla. So be okay. This is horrible advice, or at least no advice. How do I get you away from the group of people and get you to come home with me? I want something like you fake an injury and I help you to the door and I throw you in the back of my van. That's what I'm talking about.
Or help me find my lost puppy.
Can you just tell your group of friends I'm going home with this guy tonight?
Probably not, unless you prove to them that you're real.
Maybe we should talk about the piercings.
Yes. You do have some interesting piercings.
Three on the one in the tongue, one on the lower lip, and one on the upper lip.
Yes. Now, I understand what the one in the tongue is for, but what does the lower lip and upper lip get me?
What does it get you?
Well, the tongue, they say, enhances the fellatio, yes?
Yeah. Maybe.
Adam, be real.
I'm sorry.
Adam, you got to be yourself and be confident.
I'm not being real enough. All I'm saying is when I see...
Hey, piercings are just my style.
When I see the pierced tongue, that says open for business to me. You know what I mean? That's the welcome.
Yeah.
No?
Maybe that's your welcome. It's not my welcome.
Okay, other piercings are there.
Chris?
Hey.
What's up? How say you?
Well, I say... It's easy to see how this chick, she must be good looking because that must be all she's got going for her.
Oh.
She got no brains whatsoever, man.
Christine, is he being real?
Kind of
he's being real.
Chris, you better start being real with yourself.
He's being real.
Hey, how say you, fish tank?
Uh-oh. Asking the fish tank.
Fish tank seems to agree.
All right, I will not sit there and take these insults levied at our guest. Jeremy?
Dude, is she high or what?
She's hot. I don't know if she's high.
No, he said high, but that's actually a reasonable question. You're not high.
No, actually, I don't smoke weed. Sorry.
Really?
She cannot be that hot. She sounds so stupid.
Well,
wow.
I would say, please, please, this is an attack. I'm sorry.
He's just trying to be real.
All right. Now, I have another question for you. What if... What is the worst thing you can do when you're trying to pick somebody up? What's the biggest mistake you can make besides not being real?
She's thinking.
Deaf frat guy answers faster.
Yeah, be a one-upper, like I said before.
Don't be a one-upper.
Okay. Be a one-upper.
Don't be one. Yeah.
I'm not sure I know what a one-upper is.
Yeah, I don't know
exactly
how one-upper works.
Give me an example. Like, if I'm trying to pick you up and I were to say, you know...
Give her an upper, please.
Yeah.
give me a one-upper.
I'm going to try to, pick you up.
Good.
You look beautiful. You know, I got a new convertible. It's not the most expensive Porsche. It's the medium-sized one, but it's a convertible. It's a nice night. Want to go for a ride?
Yeah, you know, I just actually bought a Porsche the other night, so, you know, it's kind of better than your car.
Oh, okay. Yeah, but I got the convertible.
But my Porsche is better, though.
Mine's black.
So, mine's red, and mine's still better than yours.
I'm going to go in the corner and masturbate. So don't one-up. Don't one-up if you're the person who's being picked up.
Exactly.
If you want to be picked up, but what if you don't want to be picked up? Then you should be the one-upper.
Yeah, maybe.
All right. Sound advice. It is, we're going to do some news. We're going to do some sports. Christine Dolce, are we not allowed to mention Playboy?
Adam, don't mention Playboy.
Yeah, you know what?
Yes.
I actually just shot with Playboy recently, but can't talk about it fully. If I told you everything, I'd have to kill you.
Mm-hmm.
But
I don't want to be a one-upper, but I did a spread for Colt Roundup just last week.
Yes.
Fairly high circulation in certain communities. Calling all homos. Yes. Sorry. But we can't talk about the Playboy
thing. Actually, my website launches tomorrow, forbiddenexo.com, and you can find out all the updates and news.
I'm going to update you.
All right. Let's take a break. I think we'll take a break. We'll do news. We'll do sports. Christine Dolce, thanks for coming in. Dave's got a jerk report coming in. I know you're a fan of that, Christine. We'll take a quick break. Kane, the 7-foot wrestler, the big red monster, is coming in as well. All that after this.
The Adam Carolla Show. Comedy, opinions, celebrities, news, sports, and so much more.
This is Tori Spelling. You're listening to the insert adjective here. Adam Carolla Show. I get it.
He's as funny as he thinks he is. The Adam Carolla Show.
Mm-hmm. If I could play the guitar, this is what I would play. I would just sit around and play this all day. Get a guy in the drums. A little Chuck Berry song covered by George Thorogood. Why are we playing this song? Well, A, I like it. B, doesn't get played on the radio. Sure, Bad to the Bone is effed out, but we don't get to hear this one. And we got a Gibson guitar to give away. So you call in about 8:30, somewhere in the middle 8 o'clock hour. You know how the game goes. Put the phone down, pick up the axe. Play a lick from this song. It wasn't me. I don't care if you play the Chuck Berry version or the George Thorogood version. I guess they're exactly the same. Play us a good lick. Come in tomorrow. You can win yourself $1,000 worth of Gibson guitar. I want to hear the song. George Thorogood, good. I wouldn't mind seeing him. All right.
I hear he puts on a nice live show.
Well, let me just hear the riff for a second. Here's, you could play this. Oh, next one. Yeah. Oh, you want me to play it, Brisket? Brisket's showing it to me. I saw it. It's right behind me.
I'm chubby or I'm a lesbian. If he could play Brusca. If he could play.
All right, here's what I would do if I could play this. If you can play this, you can get yourself another guitar. I'm guessing you already own one. This is how you know it's Chuck Berry, because every Chuck Berry song sounds the same. Even George Thorogood Chuck Berry songs sound exactly the same. All right.
You and Michael J. Fox are kindred spirits.
That's right. Jerry?
Yeah.
You got something to say?
Yeah, Christine from MySpace. Kind of sounds like the drunken three mascots. Am I the only one? Or?
I've never seen them in the same room at the same time.
No. It's a good point. Yeah, she has less girth, but I don't know if her brain weighs more. All right. How's it?
Wait, are you trying to one-up Adam?
Don't one-up me, dude. That's the biggest mistake you can make when you're out clubbing.
I was about to throw her out the same way I throw out the drunken tree mask.
Yeah.
Her act stinks.
What act? All right. Yeah. All right, thank you. I found her to be delightful. Jason?
Hey, what's going on, Adam?
What? How say you?
Hey, man, I got to tell you, this girl that's on there, now, I've never seen her. She might be fine as all hell. Who knows? But, I could guarantee you, if you approached her with her group of friends at a club, she would never even get to know the real you. She's probably so materialistic, if you weren't gold-plated, she wouldn't even look at you.
I tend to disagree. I think she would see right through the buck teeth and the Brillo head to my beautiful sense of humor and glowing aura and immediately go home with me. It's funny because Jason's called Jason from Las Vegas, it says up here on the screen. Jason from Las Vegas, it says, Christine, epitome of a dumb blonde, although the first three times I looked at it, I pronounced it epitotomy. And I thought, wow, that's ironic. I can't pronounce the word that comes before dumb blonde. Epitotomy, my brother.
Let me ask her this question. When you go to a club, do you expect a guy to buy you a drink, or do you take a dollar to buy your own?
Oh, just don't. She's on her way. She's climbed into her magical pink van and is heading toward the clouds right now. But I will answer this for her by saying, just do not one-up her, dude.
Yeah.
Whatever it is.
And be real.
And be real. Be yourself. That's what they love. And that's the other thing, too. When the smoking hot chick, this is a quint. When smoking hot chicks tell guys just be themselves and they'll get laid, that is horrible advice. Just like when smoking hot supermodels tell fat, ugly chicks, hey, if you feel beautiful If you feel beautiful. How you feel inside of you is not good for anything in society. I don't care if a guy loves himself, feels hot, feels worthy, he's not going to get laid. And if a super fat troll of a chick feels beautiful, then she is. No, she's not.
If I may point out another irony, and I'm not saying those were fake breasts, but it's highly unlikely that they were real.
Yes.
So she herself wasn't being real.
Well, that's a good point. My advice is, who cares what you feel about yourself? I don't care if the inside of you is filled with earthworms and cockroaches.
And
go to the tanning salon and hit the goddamn treadmill, fatty.
Yeah,
that's my advice. Thank you. Speaking of all that matters, now it is time.
You were going to say, speaking of hitting the treadmill.
Here comes Big Dad. Now it is time for the naturally beautiful Teresa Strasser with the news.
This is a little bit of a difficult transition, but I'm going to pull it off. Mexico warned yesterday that if National Guard troops detain migrants on the border, the government of Mexico will file lawsuits here in the United States courts. Mm-hmm. Mexican officials are concerned that bolstered security at the border will lead to more immigrant deaths. Last year, an estimated 500 people died trying to cross the border.
Let me explain something about Mexico giving its warnings to us.
Yes.
That is like your fat, drunk, out of work brother-in-law threatening to leave your sofa after 8 days if this continues. Please get the F out of our house, you fat, drunk, lawless scumbag. You guys have nothing. You know nothing. You run a horrible country. Look, forget about countries. Let's not call them countries. Let's call them hotels. We have one hotel. They have another hotel. They have the Flamingo. We have the Mirage. Everybody in your goddamn hotel is fleeing out of the lobby and trying to sit by our pool. What does that say about your hotel? Forget about borders. Forget about nationalities. Forget about time zones. Forget about countries. Forget about nations. Forget about flags. Hotels, everybody. Let's break the entire world up into hotels. Let's have Africa be a hotel. Let's have Mexico be a hotel. Let's have Switzerland be a hotel. Let's have Canada be a hotel. Let's have the United States be a hotel. Whose hotel is at maximum capacity, and whose hotel is everyone fleeing the lobby of?
You're saying no vacancy.
Smoking sucks.
That's all you need to know.
Okay.
No vacancy at the good old US of A hotel. Plenty of rooms over at the Mexican hotel. So shut up. You guys need to change your lounge act, you need to change your bedding, and you need to attract more customers. Until then, shut up.
Mint on the pillow and some turn down.
Please
service.
Turn something down and fill the goddamn mini bar or shut up.
Continental buffet. Breakfast
yes.
buffet with some nice fresh croissants.
Let's talk about the Dutch.
Please.
The Dutch don't make you as angry. The Dutch army, who sent troops to Afghanistan
nice
last
hotel.
Year. Beautiful hotel in over there in Holland.
Smoke a little weed, bang a hooker.
And
wake up at noon.
They've got a force now in Afghanistan hoping to keep the peace. They named it Operation Unicorn, which inspired ribbing from Canadian, British, and American troops. The taunt, unicorns are gay. The Dutch force is now called the Oruzgan Task Force, based on the province where the Dutch are stationed.
Mm, yeah. Well, it's tough when it's like, who are you guys? We're Delta Force. Who are you guys? Screaming Eagles. Who are you guys? Death from above. And what about you guys? We're the unicorns.
We're the unicorns.
So you're saying it is gay.
Not sure about the rainbow patches. That could attract fire.
Operation Chaps was already taken, apparently. In entertainment news on American Idol last night, Catherine McPhee dazzled with her song Somewhere Over the Rainbow, but her first song, I Believe I Can Fly.
Mm.
Paula Abdul didn't really have much to say about it.
She's usually so eloquent.
Yes. Here she does her best to break down the vocals. And here's what happens.
Catherine, that color for you is gorgeous. And I'm just saying that because as a woman speaking to a gorgeous woman, you look beautiful. I.
Nice.
And
$6 million, everybody. $6 million for 4 months work for Dave. You look great in that Pittsburgh jersey. But as far as the comedy, I just
Okay, how about something a little more awkward?
Well, you really learn about singing when you listen to Paula Abdul talk about it.
How much longer do we have to put up with this crap show? How many more weeks until
we
decide?
Well, there's only three left this week, one eliminated, and then next week the finale.
Hurry up.
Another week, and then 100 years after that.
Okay, Alec Baldwin, who is just a phenomenal actor, mm-hmm. love him as an actor, mm-hmm. but unfortunately he tried his hand at radio.
Uh-oh.
And we have some tape of that.
Mm-hmm. When can we take some calls, Ivan?
Whenever we want.
Do we have calls that are on there now?
No calls yet.
What number do people call to get on the air, Ivan? Do we have that number?
It's right there.
Oh, do I have the call number in front of me? Oh, I'm so sorry. That's interesting. Do we have any calls yet there, Ivan? No calls. Let's read some more about Scientology. Is Sean Hannity a Scientologist? Alec Baldwin, posing the big questions tonight here. Do we have any calls here yet, Ivan? None. Boy, it's just incredible.
What was he doing? He was filling in
in Philadelphia, and you know, you make it look so easy, Adam. But apparently, it's not that easy just giving out a number, taking calls.
Yeah. Well, I would say something bad about him, but he's a dear, dear friend.
I love him. Can I say this? He's one of my favorite actors in one of my favorite movies. Mm-hmm. And just so you can remember him, how he should be, how mm-hmm. he is at mm-hmm. his best.
Mm-hmm. You know what it takes to sell real estate? It takes brass balls to sell real estate.
Mm-hmm.
Stick to that.
I love Hunt for Red October, too. Although I don't remember the real estate part in that movie.
Okay, I'm Teresa Strasser, and that is the news.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
NBA playoffs game 5 classic last night between the Clippers and Suns in the Valley of the Sun. As I say, double overtime it took to settle this one. Sean Marion, dynamite for the Suns. 36 points, 20 boards. Elton Brand, great as usual for the Clips. Sam Cassell brought the Clips back from way down in the second half. Force the overtime. Then the Clips are up 3 as time is winding down at the end of the first overtime. Rajah Bell, Kobe Bryant's nemesis, hits a 3 to force the second one. Suns go on to win it 125-118. Tomorrow night, the two teams get it on again in L.A. Clips in a must-win situation. National pastime. As always, some good news and some bad news. Mm. The good news first. The Giants were winners. Halos, Athletics, Arizona Snakes. By the way, sometime to be a sports fan in Arizona. You got the Snakes now are in first place in the division.
Mm-hmm.
You got the Suns beating not one, but now on the cusp of beating 2 L.A. basketball teams.
Yeah.
You know, you got, who else do you have? The Cardinals mm-hmm. on the rise with Matt Leinart.
Yeah, they look like they're going to be good this year.
If it weren't for that creep Gretzky, they'd have it all. Bonds, by the way, homerless, but the big story from that game against Houston, Russ Springer beamed him, and the crowd went wild. I'm almost starting to feel bad for him, and now it looks like Springer's going to get suspended or fined or both or
did
something.
Did he beam him on purpose, or sometimes you have to pitch inside to Bonds?
Mm-hmm.
Well, first of all, he wears that armor. You know, it's ridiculous. As if he isn't already made of steel from the years of steroids. He's now holds a shield basically on his elbow.
Right.
Thank you, Bruska.
Move forward.
Yes. Anyway, right. I'm going to ignore Bruska's interruptions into our conversation.
Yes.
Anyway, the bad news is the Dodgers lost, the Padres lost, mm-hmm. the Mariners lost.
Well, Dodgers now a game under 500.
No, they're now even Steven.
Oh, they're now 500.
500.
So they're only 21-21, 19-19.
Yeah.
And again, if you're listening, Dodger fans, and I know I am, if you got, first off, only a short 130 games left in the season, number one. Number two, you can only afford to lose another between 65 and 72 games. Otherwise, the season's over.
All right,
over.
Mussolini, the World Cup stops next month.
They're 20-20. Does anyone understand? We could start the season today,
and
it would be fine.
Your precious soccer tournament begins next month. Wait till
it's
then.
It's not a real sport.
Now, here's the playoffs to talk about. Stanley Cup tonight up in Edmonton. Oilers lead the San Jose Sharks 3-2. Crowd of Canadians ought to be in a real lather because the game in San Jose booed the Canadian national anthem. It ought to be something. More importantly, though, this could be it for the Sharks and their main man, my main man, Jonathan Chichu. By this time tomorrow, we might be talking about the halcyon days of Chichu, and Tamu.
another police song.
That's right. Chee choo choo choo, Tamu moo moo, is all I want to say to you. Chee choo choo choo, Tamu moo moo, sharks and ducks will pull it through. Chee choo choo choo, Tamu moo moo, my favorite names belong to you. Chee choo choo choo, Tamu Tamu.
Dave Damashek's number one sport.
All righty. Now we have a 7-foot wrestler, Kane, coming in studio. The big red monster. We'll talk to him in just a second, and we'll be back. We have the jerk report coming up. We have our Gibson guitar giveaway. Play a little It Wasn't Me, and we'll have the big finals tomorrow, of course. Doug, the Indian intern, is doing his Hollywood happenings, all still coming up on the program.
Last Friday, with $1,000 on the line.
How do I sign off each show?
Mahalo.
Mo Damashek, because you're the queen of all moms.
But then, an unexpected twist.
Mo has generously not accepted the $1,000. No. It will roll over in the kitty and be worth $2,000 next week.
So that means this Friday, someone's going to walk away with $2,000. And all you got to do to win is beat Dave's mom. Will someone win the cash, or will Mo Damashek get another chance to feed the kitty? Find out Friday on The Adam Carolla Show.
You said that date.
What date? You talking about May 19th?
This rage. Kane has stepped to the outside, coming to the top rope.
You can't say May.
No.
Don't say the date.
Don't say it.
May.
No. Mm-hmm. No. Just say the
Kane in studio. It's like saying Niagara Falls.
Yeah.
To the Three Stooges. You can't do it slowly. But, they turn.
Oh, Adam.
Sorry, Kane. Sorry.
You just compared me to the Three Stooges.
Well, you're way more than all three of them, and you're taller than all three of them. Kane is 7 foot tall, 300 pounds, and you know him from the WWE Raw. Monday nights, 9 o'clock, all on the USA Network. Also going to be starring in See No Evil, which hits the theaters this Friday. Big Tad?
Yes, sir.
You a huge fan of Kane?
Oh, yeah, tremendous fan of the whole WWE experience, but Kane is one of the main superstars that I like on the show.
Known as the Big Red Monster, why can't you say the date,
no,
May?
No. He freaks out. Yeah, if you watch the show, you say the date, he flips and... As you heard on the clip, he'll hit you with a chair.
We won't say the date, but what is the significance of the date, Kane?
I don't really want to talk about that.
You can't right even now. Talk about no. why no. you don't talk about it.
Right.
Wow. So I hear if you say May 19th
wait.
To this Whoa. Guy, Kane, Whoa. He kind of flips out.
Kane? It's Big Dad Whoa. Here.
Uh-oh.
May 19th. May 19th.
We recorded.
May 19th.
Hey,
May 19th.
You May 19th. Do you think this is a joke?
May 19th.
May 19th. You think this whole thing May 19th. Is a joke?
No.
Do you
no,
think
no,
I'm kidding?
No.
Do you know who I am? Do you know what I am?
Yeah.
Tad was dumped from his chair. The tremors are still being felt.
Oh.
I can't believe we all survived Tad falling off a chair.
Left a trail of Cheetos and fecal matters. He scurried out of the studio.
Wow. Kane picked him up like a rag doll, tossed him down.
Well, I apologize for that. That clip wasn't supposed to run.
Yeah, I hope that wouldn't play again because I don't want to know what would happen.
I'm sorry, Kane. I don't condone that. Big Tad was mocking you. He thought he was safe in the other studio. I didn't know that was coming. There's no way we could have seen that coming.
That's all right.
All right.
Big Tad ain't feeling so big right now.
No.
What a show of strength.
Took Big Tad.
To throw down 478 pounds of fat Tad.
We did weigh him. He's 333,
and he just threw him like a Nerf ball to the ground. Thank God. He did have gravity on his side. Tad does fall a little bit faster than most of us. See No Evil. Let's talk about this movie. Out this Friday. What's the general story? Give us a thumbnail sketch of the movie.
The general story is a group of juvenile delinquents show up at an abandoned hotel to do community service. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately for them, the character that I play, Jacob Goodnight, lives in the abandoned hotel. Mm-hmm. And it's basically a story of it's a clash of cultures, if you will. Mm-hmm. It's what happens when juvenile delinquents run into a serial killer.
And you're living in this hotel. You're basically transient. You're flopping in this hotel, or you're living in there?
No, I live in it. Jacob lives in it. He's got himself an alarm system built. Mm-hmm. He's got all sorts of traps and stuff. So, no, it's a... It's his kingdom.
So, sort of like, I'll tell you, the best, to me, the best still Halloween. I remember being 16, seeing that movie, maybe 15, seeing it in the theater, and sitting next to a girl, Phyllis Tyler, who I had a crush on. It was so scary, she broke wind in the middle of it. Yes, he popped his head up from behind the sofa, and Phil's like...
That's a good, but Kane, that's a great tagline for your movie. So scary, you'll fart.
Break wind.
You'll break wind like Phyllis Tyler. Yeah. So is it in that? Who was the motivation for you? I mean, what did you use a composite of movie greats to develop your character?
You.
This is totally original.
Yeah.
Do we see you? Yeah. Are you masked? Are you wearing a jumpsuit? What do you wear?
No, I wear dirty clothes, actually.
Yeah.
The hotel's burnt out, and it's an awful dirty place.
Well,
so I don't think there's any running water in it either.
Kane doesn't need a hockey mask or devil horns or anything. If you saw him wearing just some tattered Dockers, you'd be plenty good and scared.
Imposing. Yes. Now, yeah. Kane, you once set Jim Ross, the announcer of the WWE, on fire. What happened there?
I was trying to explain myself and get things across to JR, and he wasn't really understanding. So I figured it'd just be something neat to do.
Sometimes you can clarify with fire.
Yeah,
I like that.
It cuts through the fog of dialogue.
Yes. Can I steal that from you? I like that.
Feel free. Actually, if I find some gas and a lighter, I'm going to track Tad down here in a little bit.
Oh, we could feed all the starving people in the world if we would cook him up.
Well,
the Tad BBQ.
He'd be like an Iraqi oil field, by the way. He'd burn for years. all the blubber and all the fat on him would continuously burn.
I don't know, all the toxic waste that would probably come out of that. It'd
That's
be an environmental
true.
Disaster.
Yes, we'd have to get the Superfund people in here to clean it up, but he'd be like the eternal, he'd be like Kennedy's eternal flame. We'd be going on year number six and walk by a burning Tad in the hallway.
Tourists coming by to see it.
Kane, set Big Tad on fire. Would appreciate that. See No Evil in theaters this Friday, and of course, WWE Raw Monday nights, 9 o'clock on USA Network. Oh, before we leave, Kane, how about you take your 300 pounds, your bulging muscles, and your 7-foot frame and whack our Hooters punching bag? See how you score.
Adam Carolla, by the way, holds the record at 574.
Really?
Yes. I don't know if that's Hooters accurate, Brusk. I think I did better than that myself.
Let's see how Kane does.
Yeah.
I did, I think.
Thank you.
Here comes Kane.
Oh, he opened hand
socks it.
He bitch slapped it.
Not unlike what he did to Tad, and he still ranges up into 535. Not bad for an open-handed crack.
No, definitely holds the bitch slap record.
Yeah.
I still have the close fist record, though. Kane, thanks. Come by anytime.
Tad won't be here next
Feel
time,
free to strangle the life out of Big Tad out in the hallway there.
Okay.
Please, and any of my other enemies you may happen upon in your journeys, feel free to bitch slap them as well. We'll take ourselves a quick break. We have Dave's Jerk Report coming up. Also, we have our Gibson guitar giveaway. Doug, our Indian intern, is going to do his Hollywood happenings. All coming up after this.
You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show, where everyone is entitled to Adam's opinion.
The guys that do the healing and the preaching have the most exotic hair. That, to me, is a strike. When I see someone with crazy hair, I think crazy. If they're talking about the Lord and they have crazy hair, now we're out.
Stick around. We'll be right back with more of The Adam Carolla Show.
All the music I like is good. You ever notice that?
I also noticed that all the music you like was recorded in 1983 or prior.
Yes. This is George Thorogood is playing a little song by Chuck Berry called It Wasn't Me. If you got a guitar and you got a phone and you know this song, you could win yourself $1,000 worth of Gibson SG Special guitar. Done it before. You call in, play your riff. If it's good enough, we'll bring you in. Tomorrow we'll do it live, and someone's walking away with $1,000 worth of Gibson guitar. All right. So get that ready. But
so
first,
someone should master this lick. It's a straight blues, you know, plugged in blues riff.
Yeah, to me, it doesn't matter whether you play the middle riff, the end riff, the beginning riff. We'll either dig it or we won't. Mm-hmm. You know, I think for all our things, whether you're doing a Cheech U Tamu song or whether you're playing a riff from Hocus Pocus and a song Focus, either way, you just do a good job and you're in.
That's a nifty idea.
Yeah.
Next time we have a Gibson to give away, let's have him do it to the tune of a Cheech U Tamu.
That's not at all what I was saying. But now, if you want to play this riff, it's coming up now, too. Just rock and we'll take you in. We don't want to put any confines on your creativity. Just impress.
He knows ready to rock.
Hmm.
Me.
What a surprise.
He knows ready to wipe. Big Tad.
That was spectacular. Kane knocked Fat Tad right out of his chair.
I wonder if that actually hurt his tailbone as he went down.
If he had one, it would have. Yeah, scared the bejesus out of Big Tad.
Uh-oh. I'd like to thank you a-holes for doing that to me.
Tad.
Uh-oh.
Let me just explain something. Much like a young child or even a pet, the lines of reality are blurred with Big Tad. You know, pro wrestling, well, maybe it's fake. Maybe these guys are just professionals. Maybe they're just actors. When a 7-foot, 300-pound guy gets in your grill and your Big Tad, you masturbate to WWE every single night. That is frightening. Tad, you were legitimately fearing for your life, were you not?
You know I'm an actor, right?
Yes, you were acting very scared there.
Thank you.
All right, now, leave yourself. Pretend the studio is a huge zit in your pus.
Don't fall into the giant crevice that you created when you fell out of your chair. We're going to have to get that fixed.
Speaking of fixing things, Dave Damashek, now about to fix the world. How do you like that? One jerk at a time for the little something we call the Jerk Report.
The Jerk Report with Dave Damashek.
How long you two been working together?
Brian, you're out. You know what? I'm going to spare you. I want to be benevolent. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to put you on the Jerk Report, at least not yet. Mm-hmm. First of all, though, as always, it's worth mentioning, yes, this is the Jerk Report. Yes, that is creep you hear underneath. Mm-hmm. If you feel that you need to point that out to everybody, you have just made the Jerk Report. Now, let's move on. You remember those old Dockers commercials? Mm-hmm. The ones with the close-ups of the guy's pants and they were talking about whatever?
Sure.
And they're supposed to be cute or funny or
I don't know
they're
what happens when you, your black buddy, your Asian buddy, and your Mexican buddy all hang out on the same porch sipping a light beer and having a conversation about ladies that doesn't involve any swear words.
Yes. Well, those have gotten the way of the dodo bird, but they've got a whole new batch now, completely different theme, just as annoying. You probably have heard this one on the air. It's chance run-ins, romantic encounters between strangers. A man and a woman, and they find each other. This has been playing incessantly.
I want a Sunday kind of love.
sweet Jesus, if I have to hear this song again. Listen, this one, this is the one where the woman runs into the glasses and the bottle spins and it points at the guy and they look at each other like, oh yeah, something's going to go down here.
Yeah.
That one's sickening. The other one is the two trolley cars pull up next to each other. The guy eyes the girl, she eyes him. He gets off the train, his car runs over to hers, she gets off of hers, and they meet up.
Yes.
And they look at each other like, oh yes, here's a little thing for you, Dockers. Stop creating these fantasies for men, because here's what happens in real life, fellas. You get off your trolley car, run onto the other trolley car, and say, hey, it was me, you were just looking at me on the other thing. She pulls the handle and says, police, this guy's stalking me, this guy just jumped off a train and is now standing over me.
Please. It's happened to me 1,000
Dockers,
times.
Dockers, jerks.
Kri has a long way to go for that. Or her boyfriend's Kane stands up.
Yes.
And you plot yourself like
now,
Big
listen,
Ted.
I've issued this warning already, but the jerks continue to come and go as they please, but no longer. Mm. Because I'm not on a hunt by myself. No. The army, like the rebellion is swelling with troops.
There's others.
Yes.
Others have joined your jerk army.
Now. Yes. Here's a great one from somebody named Opasuk.
Opasuk.
Opasuk. Something like that. She has a great idea.
Mm-hmm.
She says we should have get out of being a jerk card. Mm-hmm. Get out of jerk free card.
Mm-hmm.
Juan Pierre, the Cubs last week. Barry Bonds hit what would have been a home run. Juan Pierre went up and stole it and kept it from being a home run.
Center field.
Juan Pierre, get out of jerk free card. Russ Springer yesterday, he beans Barry Bonds. Get out of jerk free card.
Right, so you're saying...
I like that.
Later on, they could shoot a Docker spot.
And be fine.
And yes. Be fine because they had to get out. It's like the immunity idol in Survivor.
There you go. Neutralizes the effect of being a jerk.
That's a solid idea. Rowboat, he's upset about this Paris Hilton thing. With she has a video game dedicated to her. Mm-hmm. She can't even do them the justice of learning the name of the video game dedicated to her.
Yeah.
Crepe.
Yeah.
What? What? I slip of the tongue. Oh, my God.
Wow.
She's a jerk.
Oh.
And you know what? For the first time ever since I had that slip of the tongue, I'm a jerk.
Turn the laser on himself.
Damn it. Not happy about that.
Yeah.
Let's just move on.
Takes a big man, though.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Listen to this. Brian Burwell, reporter of the St. Louis newspaper. He's on TV the other day talking about Barry Bonds. Here's his theory about why people aren't supporting Barry Bonds.
Barry Bonds is paying a severe penalty for being a jerk. God, human nature is that, you know what? When you fall and you've been a jerk, people are going to pile on.
Yeah, you know what? I agree, Brian Burwell. You know why? Because I said it! Brian Burwell, don't steal my lines! Jerk!
Yes.
Such a rare phrase.
The word didn't exist before Damashek coined it. I remember some weeks ago, Damashek saying, I have an idea for a bit on the radio program. It's called the Jerk Report. I said, that's fine, except for what does jerk mean?
Right.
Right.
Exactly.
He sat down and explained it to me, and I said, maybe this will catch on with sports reporters.
I detect hint of sarcasm.
Uh-oh.
I hope you detect this. Jerk! Jerk!
We both got it.
He gave us the...
Thank you.
Two-barrel jerk shot there.
Wait, keep the gun fired up because there's someone else in this studio that has to go down.
But remind us again what jerk means. I mean, it's such a... I'm not sure I've ever heard that
word
before.
Give her the jerk laser again.
Apparently can't learn her lesson. Now, there's someone named Brusca.
Brusket, I think he's been renamed.
Brisket has been renamed. There have been a number of issues, apparently. People in the hallways, apparently, have complained to Fat Tad that Brusca isn't friendly.
Really?
That's right.
You mean he puts the brusque in Brusca?
Yes.
I'm not friendly to you, I know that.
Thank you.
I've been on this report more than Bonds or as much.
This is what the people say. Billy, our 17-year-old webmaster, also says that you were mean to him, and he requested that you be on the jerk report. The evidence is overwhelming. Judge rules, jerk! Right. How about this one? This one really gets under my skin.
Mm-hmm.
The Dodgers, mm-hmm. they email us. They mm-hmm. say, hey, we'd love for Adam Carolla to come out and see our new field box seats. They're yeah. really handsome nice. Seats.
I'd love to, too.
Right. Yeah. Well, mm-hmm. The woman writes in. She says, hey, do you think Adam wants to sit in the baseline seats against the Rockies? We're trying to promote these seats, so on and
mm-hmm.
so forth.
Mm-hmm.
Your assistant mm-hmm. sends back, well, Adam's wife is soon to give birth, and mm-hmm. so it's not convenient for her. Mm-hmm. How about instead we send Dave Damashek? He's
Makes
our
sense.
Sports guy.
Right.
Let
You're
us know.
Sports guy.
Yeah.
She responds, the woman responds, we'll wait for Adam in the middle of the summer when his schedule frees up.
Wow.
See if your schedule can fit this in. You're a jerk.
You inked in jerk on her schedule. All right.
I don't know
I
what
say
that
saint.
Means.
Yeah.
I don't like that at all.
I like it.
We'll
I
wait.
Like it a lot.
What an outrage.
All right, look, if they can get, listen, Dodgers, if you guys can get a game and a half over 500 at any point in your 13-month season, I will gladly be at that game. Please.
Listen, I already have done it, but do I have to do it again? It's our national pastime.
Right. Do you understand if the season started tomorrow, the Dodgers would be exactly where they were before the season started?
Oh, Brezhnev, the World Cup will be played in a month. Adam Carolla, jerk! All right. This gets under my skin. Mm-hmm. Stanley Cup playoffs are going on, and it mm-hmm. reminds me, because the Buffalo Sabres are doing nicely. They always had great uniforms, blue and gold, handsome, striking. Mm-hmm. Suddenly, a few years ago, they decide, no, not good enough. They skate out onto the ice, black, red, and silver.
Yeah.
You don't get to change your uniforms once you decide.
No.
You start a team, you choose your colors. Those are your colors for all of time.
Right.
You don't get to revise the uniforms. That's not as egregious as this one, though.
That is your country's flag,
yes.
essentially.
Right.
That's
Absolutely.
It.
You don't take the pinstripes off the Yankees.
Founding fathers decide on your flag. That's the flag that you fly.
You,
that's
sir,
it.
Have just earned yourself a ticket out of the jerk report.
Yeah.
Because let me tell you something. Our nation's flag is red,
white,
blue.
Hold on, what's
blue.
It sound like when I leave the jerk report?
Jedi.
Ah,
no, not everyone gets a lightsaber.
Okay, thanks, buddy.
Getting off the Death Star.
Now, our flag, red, white, and blue.
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's a hockey team in Washington, D.C., which I believe is our nation's capital.
Mm-hmm.
The hockey team is called the Washington Capitals.
Mm-hmm.
They play in our nation's capital. They wear red, white, and blue, of course, right?
Sure, makes right. sense.
What's the problem?
Oh, no.
No?
They wear turquoise, gold, and black. Shame!
That's the Libyan flag, by the way. Benedict Arnold's.
Jerks! New name for the team.
Yeah, everyone's...
The Washington Jerks.
That turquoise is so effed out. Somebody decided to enter that into the lexicon of sports colors about 9 years ago, and it took off like wildfire.
and I have so many things to get to. By the way, I'm going to save some for next week. There's too many jerks. That's the shame of it, unless we can do another half hour, 45 minutes.
No. I'm sure Brusket doesn't mind.
No, Brusket doesn't
I don't want
mind.
To be in the jerk report next week. Take your time.
Oh, see, someone's learning their lesson. I like that.
The power.
I also want to talk about Natalie Holloway, but I'll save that one for next week.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. So let's just get right to it. The creep of the week. I don't know if this comes as a surprise to anybody. But for the 15th straight week, Barry Bonds, creep of the week. Let me tell you why, specifically.
Mm.
We talked about the obviously the steroids and the beanings and the body armor he wears, the plates, so on and so forth. Here's one, again from Opasuk. This is another one pointed out from the message board. Opasuk points this one out.
Mm-hmm.
Barry Bonds, last Sunday, it was Breast Cancer Awareness Day.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the ballplayers, they all wore pink armbands.
Mm-hmm.
And many of them used pink bats. First of all, if you're such a jerk, you can't use a pink bat, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know what. But
yeah.
Specifically, Barry Bonds, not only did he not use the pink bat, he couldn't even wear the pink armband.
Really?
Well, yeah, maybe he's for breast cancer.
Well, yeah, that's what I was just going to say. I mean, yeah, he obviously, Opasuk, as a matter of fact, points this one out. This means that he hates women and loves cancer. I'll tell you what I hate.
Mm.
You jerk. creep of the week, and that's that.
I was thinking, what if you use one of those pink bats to club a baby snow seal? You'd be torn, I think, as you watch that. You know what I mean?
You mean your karma.
Yeah, really mixed feelings. It would be strange for the karma gods to decipher.
Oh, that poor animal, but I should get my breasts checked
out. That's right.
It reminds
self-examination.
Me to get my mammogram, but right. The baby seal is dead.
Yes, well, you know. Barry not making any more friends over there in San Francisco.
But Dodger speaking of making friends, I will still take those box levels.
Did he give, by the way, a reason why he didn't use the pink bat or use the pink armband?
I don't want his excuses.
But what did he offer up? Because someone must have asked, and he must have offered up something.
This is what he offered up.
I'm learning a lot every day. I learned that I suck right now.
All right, that's what he offered up.
Humble.
Jeff?
Yeah,
what do you have to say when I add to the jerk report?
Actually, I would, Dave. You missed three people. I'm thinking Billy Crystal, Jack Nicholson, and Penny Marshall for abandoning the Lakers and donning the Clippers jersey.
Good for you. Good for you. I had them written down. I just didn't get to them. Absolutely.
Turncoats.
They were in Phoenix last night rooting for the Clippers.
Mm-hmm.
Shame on you people. Yeah, you chose your team. They wear purple and gold. You now don't get, because they were eliminated, you now don't get to start rooting for the Clippers. Jerks.
All right. We'll take ourselves a quick break. When we come back, we're going to start giving away that Gibson guitar. $1,000 worth of Gibson guitar. You call in. You play the George Thorogood riff. There it is. Originally a little Chuck Berry song. Geez, you could hardly tell. Play that. We'll evaluate it. And then either you'll be in the running for $1,000 worth of Gibson guitar or possibly a candidate for next week's Jerk Report after this.
The Adam Carolla Show. This is what a year and a half of junior college sounds like.
Hi, this is Jessie Jane, and every time I get invited to come to the Adam Carolla Show, I end up taking off my clothes. I mean, I have opinions on stuff.
AdamCarolla.com. It's so much better than internet porn. The Adam Carolla Show. Someone's going to win front row tickets to the new Cars and Blondie Saturday night at Gibson Amp and a Gibson SG Special electric guitar. Qualify now on the Adam Carolla Show. Call 866-901-ADAM.
Mm-hmm. All right, you just got to play this riff, anything from this song. How do we pick it? We don't. I just drive in my car and think about licks I like. Last time was Hocus Pocus by Focus. This time it's it wasn't me. Old Chuck Berry song. Raphael?
Yeah.
You got your axe in front of you, brother?
I'm ready.
All right. You plugged in?
Right.
Where are you? Are you at home?
Yeah, I'm in my kitchen.
Nice.
Yeah, I just got done taking a few ribs to mellow out here.
Nice.
Right? like a true musician, you know?
Do you have to go to work?
What'd you say?
Do you have to go to work today?
Hold on, I think that ear's bad, bro.
Sorry.
Right. That's a bad word.
Didn't mean to harsh your mouth.
That's a bad word.
Go ahead before Dave puts you on the jerk report.
Yes, sir. Hold on.
We're all on pins and needles over here.
All right.
Yeah, no George Thorogood, but it George Thorobad, but not acceptable.
Thoroughly bad. It sounded good to me.
Essentially, we're essentially fat, bad skin, 17-year-old girls desperate for a prom date over here. So we'll take any suitor. So Raphael, you're in.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Yes. Now, can you sober up and be here tomorrow with your guitar?
Yes, I can.
Mm-hmm.
What time do I have to be there?
We're going to need you here.
By
what
eight.
Time, Brusket?
No later than 8.
No later than 8.
No problem.
And again, is this your home that you're living in, or are you living at home with your folks?
No. I mean, this is my home.
Okay.
I'm just off today.
You're off today.
Right. I just got lucky.
What do you do to pay the bills?
I sell insurance.
Wow. You didn't seem like the button-down collar type to me.
Well, but, you know, I like to do that, you know, on the side, you know?
Right. Selling insurance would actually be a good code name for selling weed.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? This is my insurance that I'll never be broke.
Yeah, and
you
also...
You know what I mean? I sell insurance out of a van.
What's the copay on that eight ball?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, if I needed an eighth of, like, some KGB, what would the...
I mean, you want the top of the line?
What would my deductible be? Yeah.
Top of the line?
Yeah.
Street price or dispensary price?
Dispensary.
$90 an eighth.
All right. Listen, weed is expensive now. They always talk about how expensive gas is, but weed, quite a bit more. You know, dime bag, that's nothing. I could see a sock in the groin. There's no such thing as $10 worth. You know what $10 worth of weed is? The guy selling the weed takes a hit off a joint, blows it in your face.
That's all you get for $10.
That's $10 these days. But the weed is so potent, doesn't need to be good. Goes a long way. Eric?
Yeah, good morning.
How say you, my brother?
I say good morning, Uncle Tom Bien.
Yeah. Oh, I forgot about Uncle Tom Bien. Yes, that was the a phrase I coined for the Mexican Uncle Tom.
Right.
Uncle Tom Bien.
Somebody was turning on his own people.
Right.
Right.
But right. Mexican hasn't version. Caught on like the word Dave invented, jerk, a few weeks back.
Be starting nice. To catch on.
Yeah, any of you guys, any sports writers out there, Uncle Tom Bien, anytime you have a Mexican guy siding with the white man. All right, go ahead, Eric.
I don't know, Raphael is pretty good, and my guitar is unplugged, so I'll do the best I can.
Are you playing an electric guitar that's unplugged?
No, this is an acoustic.
I'm playing acoustic, okay. Mm.
All right, here we go, ready?
Mm-hmm. Well, Eric, it sounds like you definitely know how to play the guitar.
I say we just don't go to the prom this year.
You'd rather stay home?
No, I actually could hear it through the acoustic guitar. I think if you had an electric guitar on your lap, you'd probably be all right. Why don't you have an electric guitar?
I'm at work right now. I work at a software company, so I don't happen to have it here.
Mm-hmm.
That's
mm-hmm.
commitment.
Yeah.
That alone should earn him entry into this tournament.
There is an acoustic guitar, however, at your software company?
Yeah, I bring it to work.
I may be old school, but if I saw one of you bead wearers coming in with your flip-flops, your hacky sack, and your acoustic guitar, it'd be, hit the bricks, hippie. You're out of here.
Are you in Silicon Valley?
That's correct, Teresa.
Yeah, we don't have any of that. I would never, you know, you see these 60 Minutes reports. Oh, here's how they do the company thing. First off, they all eat lunch out on the lawn together. Every day's casual Friday. There's no hierarchy. There's no Mr. This or Sir That. There are no doors on any of the offices. I would have the exact opposite.
Really?
I'd be wearing spats.
So, but the good news is he's in San Jose. You must be excited for the big game tonight. San Jose Sharks, Edmonton Oilers.
See?
Well, Eric, we will accept you. Unfortunately, you have to come down and play in the flesh.
I can't phone it in.
Do that every day.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. You can show up like Teresa and phone it in, but you can't literally phone it in. We'll think about it. Hang on there, Eric. We'll see just how desperate we get. Gustavo?
What's happening?
What's happening, Gustavo?
Just chilling here in a parking lot with my guitar strapped on.
Fantabulous. You want to play a lick for us?
Absolutely. Here we go.
Does anyone have an amp in North America?
Apparently not.
Well, you know, I happen to be driving and I have it in my trunk.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think you look at this glass as half empty, Ace. Mm-hmm. I think that, you know, these people are pulling their cars up. They're at work. They're playing guitar in their cubicles.
Right.
Is that all he has?
It's impressive commitment.
Gustavo.
Yes, sir.
How long have you been playing the guitar?
Since I was 16.
Since you're 16?
17 now.
Yes, you're now 17. How old
He's
are you now?
Now 14.
He actually went back. How old are you now?
I'm in my 30s.
You're in your 30s. All right. Yeah. Now, I'm thinking about taking your word for the fact that you can actually play the F out of an electric guitar.
I can play a little bit.
Will we be disappointed if we bring you down here in person tomorrow to play for this Gibson guitar?
No.
No, we will not.
No.
All right. All right, then we'll hang on. We'll bring you out tomorrow. All right, so now we have Raphael, we have Gustavo. What country are we in, by the way? Is there any guy named Tim or Bob who plays a goddamn guitar?
Apparently there aren't any Kevins left.
I want to see some blue eyes. All right, Eric is in San Jose. I don't know if he can make it out here. Let me talk to Chris. Chris? Chris?
Hello.
Do you play the guitar?
No, never. No.
All right.
Hey, but the sound guy. The soundboard guy?
Yeah.
Tremendous job.
Yeah, Brian's doing a great job. Yeah. It's going to be sad when he has to leave.
You guys really traded up there.
We really did. And not only that, he's easy on the eyes.
Easy.
He's tough on the nostrils, but he's easy on the eyes.
I haven't noticed that.
Oh, yeah.
Is he stinky? He's far away from me.
Smells I'm like trying to do my best here under really difficult circumstances.
Smells like a dead cat.
Settle down over there, Brian.
Ruben?
He is incredibly good at this job. There's no two ways about it.
Ruben?
Is this the same Ruben who won last time? No, it's not. Okay. Remember Ruben?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
It's a great show. A lot of fun. It can't be a two-time winner is what I'm saying.
Brusket, give us 10 minutes notice if you're going to become animated at any portion during the show. I'm used to the quaalude-addled sloth.
It happens so fast. It's
I know.
It
really takes you by surprise. It's like the time my dad used a word. He said, "Sea sucker," yelled it at somebody driving by in a car, and I was 8 and taken aback in that VW bug.
You don't expect it.
Little heads up, Pops. I was startled. Ruben? I got him on here. Try it again. Put him on hold. Hit him again. Oh, there we go. Ruben?
Yes.
What's up? Could you please stop masturbating and pick up the guitar?
I'm hooking up like all my hands all at one time.
All right. Are you the Ruben who won last time?
No.
And I got to say this as well, Brusket. If Ruben is the reigning king, this is like Jeopardy. We could give away 1,000 guitars. Sure. We give them all to one guy. If nobody can dethrone the king, then nobody can dethrone him.
He could be like the Jennings.
That's right.
Sounds good to me.
Go ahead. But it isn't you. You are not the Ruben that won last time. Okay. Me too. About this whole competition. Ruben, can you play something that sounds remotely like the lick that we played earlier?
Oh, yeah, I could.
Yes, this is what it would sound like.
There we go.
What
closer.
Is that?
Chong.
Johnny be bad.
Yeah, B's not good enough. It's D. D minus. Johnny D minus. Hey, Ruben.
Yeah.
The good news is, the bad news is that was horrible. The good news is there's no way you were the guy who won last time.
Hey, no, but the good news is the pot here is only $60 and they compared to
$90. Wow, all right. I'm moving out to Fresno. I'm sorry. I feel like, again, I feel like the tramp of the school and Big Tad has come calling, and at a certain point, I go, listen, I have some dignity. I'm sorry, no. You know what I mean? I have to salvage some dignity. I'm sorry, not everyone can make the cut. Let's speak to Ricky. Ricky?
Yes?
You're poised with your guitar?
I am poised with my guitar. I need that SG.
Let's hear it then. It's $1,000 bucks worth of Gibson plus tickets to go see the Cars and Blondie.
Oh, I'd love both of that.
Let's hear what you got.
Okay.
Well, again, the unplugged version, but we can see you know your way around the guitar.
A little.
Do you have an electric guitar?
I have an SG, as a matter of fact, but I've always wanted another one.
Ah.
Can't have enough.
Yeah. That doesn't make us sympathetic toward your cause.
I don't care about sympathy. I'm one deck guitar.
All right. You bring your SG in, and you play the hell out of it, and you walk away with another one.
Yeah? Okay.
All right. How long have you been playing?
A long time. Many years.
Okay. You paint a very vivid picture.
30 years.
Really? All right. We'll put you on hold. We have our three, then, Brisket?
Yeah.
We're good?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll take ourselves a quick break again tomorrow. That is going to take place here on the show.
We'll have a live guitar off.
These guys sound dynamic.
Yeah, that last guy.
You play the guitar sometimes. How long you been playing? A long time. Wow. What a picture he paints.
You got a terrible prom date.
Yes. Yeah. We'll take a quick break. Be right back after this.
Last Friday. With $1,000 on the line.
How do I sign off each show?
Mahalo.
Mo Damashek. You are the queen of all moms.
But then, an unexpected twist.
Mo has generously not accepted the $1,000. No. It will roll over in the kitty and be worth $2,000 next week.
So that means this Friday, someone's going to walk away with $2,000. And all you got to do to win is beat Dave's mom. Will someone win the cash, or will Mo Damashek get another chance to feed the kitty? Find out Friday on The Adam Carolla Show. And now, Oswaldo reads the 100 greatest movie quotes of all time. Number 29, from A Few Good Men.
You can handle the truth.
Now, back to The Adam Carolla Show.
I did that thing last night where I picked up the phone about 9:15 to make a phone call, listened for the dial tone, and there was none. It's a weird pause. You pick up the phone, you hit talk, and then you bring it up to your head. You don't hear any dial tone. You give it a pause, and then it's like, hello? Hello? Ow. Ozzy? Yeah. The phone didn't even ring. I feel like he's permeated my soul now.
Yeah, you sensed him calling.
Yeah. What is it, Ozzy? I come in tomorrow at 11. Yeah, okay. I come to the radio tomorrow.
At 11?
Oh, okay. I don't know how to tell him that he doesn't need to call and verify everything with me, so we'll see him in about an hour and 15 minutes, or make it 2 hours and 15 minutes, or make it 3 hours and 15 minutes, however it works. Point is Ozman, day does not go by without at least attempting to speak to Ozman, or I should say communicate. I'm not going to say talking to Oswaldo, I spoke to Ozzy, Ozzy and I talked about him. I'm going to say we attempted to convey ideas, we attempted to communicate. With mixed results. So here's what I was thinking about. We have news. We have sports coming up. We have a few minutes to talk about something. We're thinking about what we're going to talk about. I was thinking about it while I was urinating. I do some of my best work standing in front of the urinal. Was, by the way, standing next to a sales guy from the mother station here. Was physically leaning on the divider. Now, look, if we go to a movie theater and you want to put your arm on the armrest that divides the two of us, that's open for discussion. But how lazy do you have to be to physically rest your body on the divider between the two urinals? I don't know if he was drunk or just that tired of looking at his own urine, but he was actually sacked out on top of the divider. By the way, that divider could go up 6 or 8 inches. Because if you're a tall guy and you get a short guy on the other side of the urinal, you can see Wangus. Over the top of that. I'm 6'2", and certainly Kane, the 7-foot wrestler, would be looking at nothing but Wang standing at that thing. But I started to think of myself, as I was urinating, and, you know, my urine comes out with explosive ferocity. Mm-hmm. I whiz like it's my last, because that's the way I live my life.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Carpe piem.
Carpe piem.
Wow.
Nice.
Thank you.
Nice. I thought, this is wasted energy. And we're all always looking for alternative forms of energy. And people think about fuel, but wait a minute. You hear about the windmills.
Right.
That's capturing the energy of the wind. They're even talking about tidal energy. The tide rolls in, the tide recedes, the tide comes in and comes out. That's energy there. What is hydroelectric energy? We put a dam, we put the water up here. Right. As gravity carries water downhill, it turns a turbine that lights up Las Vegas. That's how it works. Why not a little wheel inside of those urinals? I'm putting power back on the grid as I look at the other guy's wang. Maybe a little competition. Oh, I put 19 kilowatts on the grid. How'd you do? Woo, 26. Someone drank a sixer. You know what I'm saying?
Just guys who love brew, they provide the energy for the nation.
And we
just
could
feed them six packs over and over.
I will say this. Every time I walk into the bathroom here, somebody is perched at the urinal. And I'm guessing this goes on 18 hours out of the day here, because the 5-6 hours a day I'm here, there's somebody constantly urinating. If there was a wheel that was constantly turning, we could light up the building. And then I thought, what about number two?
Oh.
Certainly that would burn. Now, in some of these impoverished nations, you know, the American Indians, before we straighten them out, used to burn hippo. They used to burn the flop of the bull, of the buffalo. Yes, they would take the buffalo chips and they would use them as fuel for the fire. It's just fuel.
Right.
It's all fuel.
Everything's sacred. They would use everything.
They would eat every part of the buffalo. The point is what about our fecal matter? Instead of piping it down to these treatment centers, cleaning it up, and then pumping it out into the ocean, perhaps it could be dried and burned and used to create a fire that would then turn water into steam and steam into electricity. Think about it. Mm-hmm. So we burn the fecal matter,
right,
and with the urine, we turn the wheels. And listen, ladies, spin your wheel too.
No, I was thinking about it because I was peeing at the same time, frankly.
Mm-hmm.
And because here you're kind of in a rush because you want to get back, you know. And I thought there was a more momentum than usual.
Mm-hmm.
And so girls can create some momentum and velocity, which could be then spinned into energy, kinetic energy.
Your electric power.
There you go.
In dung-fired furnaces. I'm just saying, now I know our diet varies a little. The buffalo's out eating grass. The elephants in Africa, they'll burn the elephant flop. They're out eating grass all day. We have the vegans and the vegetarians. Well, maybe we could get some use out of these people.
But Fat Tad's stool alone could heat the entire state of California.
But how do you harvest? How do you harvest the human waste for your plan?
First, cheap imported labor.
Right. Where would I get that here?
That's number one. We'll have to work something out. Obviously, drops in the toilet and just goes to some facility.
Right.
It is then packed into a brick and dried in a kiln, made into sort of power pellets, into burning brick pellets, like charcoal briquettes. I got to work it out, but I believe you me, I'm working on it.
Putting the P in P and E.
The only thing about the whiz wheel is we...
can't stop.
We definitely going to need the mud flap because I don't need any blow-by coming back into my face. You know what I mean? I don't need to be working my wheel up around 10,000 RPM and hitting wrestler Kane with a steady spray of my urine in the next stall. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to work it out, but once I do, the world is our oyster. And then OPEC, take that.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
So you're going to solve it. You're
Nobel
gonna do
Prize.
You're going to do the research and everything?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh. Thank goodness you almost got a high school degree.
Got my people on it already. I'm telling you it could work. Human dung. It could be burnt. We could use it. And right now, it costs billions of dollars to process, and then we pollute our oceans with it. Meanwhile, thousands of guys die in coal mines trying to harvest the coal every year. We have our own brown gold right inside our bellies right now. We're all sitting on our own coal mine. Why not utilize it, people?
More you know. Can you do a public service announcement for your new plan?
Don't waste your caca. It sucks. Yeah, we'll get Trump in here to talk about saving
smoking
fecal matter.
Smoking sucks. The air right out of your lungs.
That's such a so much nuance he read that with, didn't he? Smoking sucks.
That was his Hamlet.
Yeah, wonderful. All right, we're going to take ourselves a break. Teresa.
Yes.
What do we have to look forward to coming up in news?
Well, just officially confirmed a very, very big celebrity separation. Going to get into that. And, of course, American Idol. One of the judges said it was the best performance of the whole season. We're going to hear that and some stuff about immigrants.
All right. Right after this.
It's the Adam Carolla Show. There's a lot more coming up, so stay here.
We went and pulled a scene from When Harry Met Sally. Deaf frat guy, I guess you're going to be Harry.
Hell yeah.
And Sabina, you'll be Sally.
Okay.
Here we go.
Yes.
Oh, oh yeah.
Oh,
that
yes.
feels great. Like oh. that. Keep going.
Oh, that was so good.
Hell yeah.
Stick around. We'll be right back with more of The Adam Carolla Show.
This is Deaf Frat Guy. Give Adam a call now at 1-866-901-ADAM.
Mm-hmm. I was just listening during the commercial. They played a public service announcement, the Click It or Ticket campaign. I don't know if we heard it everywhere, but if we play it now, you'll hear it everywhere. Do we have that? Let's hear that, Bill.
All right, everybody knows that safety belts save lives. Blah, blah, blah. We've been hearing that for years. I'm just letting you know that your safety belt can save you a whole lot of hassle, too. Because from coast to coast, cops are cracking down. They've got this enforcement effort, Click It or Ticket. Pretty simple. You buckle up or you get a ticket. Consider this a friendly warning, because guess what? Cops won't be giving warnings. Remember, Click It or Ticket. This message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation.
Yeah. Click it, slow it down, and put your seatbelt on. That's the only goddamn message that's sent from this government. How about you shake your ass? How about you turn right when the signal's red and it's clear and it's legal? How about that? Do we ever get into that? Is it? And by the way, the part where we need to be reminded to put our seatbelts on, is there not an audible and visual warning inside of every single automobile that's been manufactured after 1977? Yes, you get in your car, you turn your key, and there's a light that goes off and a sound that goes off that tells you to put your goddamn seatbelt on. Forget about it.
And let me tell you something. Playing these ads and stuff, it is not free to do this. How right. about this? First order of business, let's spend the money, cure cancer. After that, anything left over, then we can play the seatbelt ads.
Jesus Christ. It's slow down, put your seatbelt on, and secondhand smoke. Are there any other issues that we face as a society? Please, Click It or Ticket. And it's not even clever, you retards.
It does rhyme.
Look, everyone, don't wear your seatbelt, but start turning right when it's red. Thank you. The more you know. Jesus Christ. Shut up, you idiots. You goddamn Click It and Ticket. Mike?
Good.
What's up?
Hey, how's it going?
Doing good.
How you doing, Adam?
Doing fantastically.
Oh, sorry. I was paying the lady here and talking to you. I'm sorry about that.
That's all right. The prostitutes need to be tipped well.
You know, I just got to say, but they don't like it when you tip them in quarters.
Yeah, that's right, buddy.
Learn that the hard
way. All right, Mike. You know this is the kiss of death because Bruskin handed me a thing that said talk to caller Mike.
This is damn exciting stuff.
Go ahead, Mike. How say you?
Okay, Adam, I found the greatest invention in the history of the world better than the wheel.
All right, let's hear it.
The no-splash urinal.
Hmm, how does that work?
Well, I was at the Wynn Las Vegas, mm-hmm. and they have a urinal with a sponge or cloth on the back, so when you urinate on it, it does not splash back. It soaks everything up that instant.
No bounce back. It's like when you go to the batting cage, they have that tarp that sort of hangs behind home plate so the ball doesn't ricochet off and hit you in the head. Just absorbs the ball.
I like the sound of it, certainly, for a robust peer like I am. I don't mm-hmm. like the splash back, but on the other hand, that thing's got to smell something awful after like 2 days worth, right?
Yeah. It's got to be rough. But I would say that if you put a bullseye on it, or better yet, turned it over and we had the baseball game.
Oh, yeah.
On the right. back, it would be fun to urinate on it.
Yeah.
Let me ask you guys a hypothetical. Is there anyone in the history of pubs, sports, or bars that's ever played the baseball game that's on the back of every single bullseye game? They all have a baseball game that is played with darts somehow. Nobody's ever played it. Nobody knows the rules. It's never been done. If I go into manufacturing dart boards, I say, screw it. You know what the back of our one's going to be? Black, mm-hmm. flat black, no baseball. No one's ever played it before.
Your sweatshop, the workers get out early because they don't have to bother painting the baseball game on the back.
Which seems a little more intricate and time-consuming right. than the actual bullseye dartboard, which is on the front side.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd like to play that game.
Before everyone leaves the sweatshop today, please, this is Boss Man Carolla, Click It or Ticket.
That's right. Oh, please. brusket or musket, I say. Where are we? We doing the news?
I think so.
All right. It is now time for Teresa Strasser and her news.
Mexican officials warning yesterday that if National Guard troops detain migrants on the border, the government is going to file lawsuits here in U.S. courts. Mexican officials are concerned that bolstered security at the border is going to lead to more immigrant deaths.
Yeah.
Last year, 500 people died trying to cross.
Here, the threats from Mexico is like a hobo yelling, you'll be hearing from my attorneys. Thanks, folks. How about you sober up? Do me a favor, Mexico. Instead of the threats against our country, how about you hammer out another plaster Paris ET with a Prussian helmet on it? My old one's getting old. Work on that. Focus on cranking out crap out of plaster Paris and sending your Porsche over here. Let us focus on the threats.
So you're not concerned?
No. Look. No, I'm not concerned. Not concerned at all. And look, we talked about it a couple hours ago, but I basically said this. Everything has a racial component in today's society. Therefore, we can't do anything. Or if you say something, you're in trouble. Somebody gets molested at a party. Now we got the Duke lacrosse team. Now there's a racial component. Now you have to watch your tongue. Immigrants come over from one country, don't have to say anything. They come over from another country where their skin is darker than ours. Then you're racist if you try to beef up the border. I agree. Let's forget about skin color. Let's forget about flags. Let's forget about borders. Let's forget about nationalities for a second. Let's just talk hotels. Mexico's one hotel. We're another hotel. Ours is at full capacity.
Right.
Theirs is emptying out like there's a fire in it. Why? Because both hotels are the same? Because they're both managed the same? Because they both offer the equal perks to the guests? Or does one motel suck? Is one motel a flea bag, dirty, filthy, expensive, corrupt motel?
No one wants to stay at the Howard Juarez. Turns out.
That's right. Your hotel sucks. We have a good hotel. That's why you want to come here. Forget about race. Now, our hotel's better than your hotel.
We were talking earlier about Clickit and Ticket, automotive safety. According to an automobile membership club survey released yesterday, the rudest drivers in America are in Miami, where speeding, tailgating, and cutting off other drivers are the most common infractions. Also among the top five cities for rudest drivers, Phoenix, New York, and of course, Los Angeles.
Phoenix is surprising to me.
Yeah, are they really rude there?
It's hot. So people get upset.
Right.
Yeah, maybe that's it. Hold on. Big Tad has a breaking news story for us here.
Human waste can be burned or buried.
Oh, it can be buried.
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. I was not aware of
By
that.
By the way,
it can be burned.
Okay, can be burned.
Yes.
All right. Okay. Tad,
thank you, Angie.
Last hour on the computer looking for that.
By the way, do you think when Christian Amanpour is reporting, Tad runs in to talk about feces and whether or not it can be burned?
Well, the point is between my urine wheel putting power back onto the grid and now my steam-powered transportation fired in the Duke furnaces, this is going to be utopia.
Let me tell you something. That's purely anecdotal. That's something off the offline. I suggest that Tad go lay one down out on the curb and put a match to it.
Well, I am hurting right now.
If I can.
Sorry. He wanted me to tell him.
If I can get back to my news.
I'm sorry. I told Tad, as soon as he finds out, break in here and tell us. All right, so human fecal matter will burn.
Yes.
Thank you, Tad.
A relationship is in the crapper. Paul McCartney and his second wife, Heather Mills, officially announced their separation today after 4 years of marriage. The statement blamed media intrusion for the separation. And by the way, there was no prenup.
Yeah. And he's worth like $1.5 billion or something.
It's epic how much he's worth. She offered to sign one. That's the report. And he said
no. So then when it comes to negotiations, and if there's no prenup when they come to negotiating, he's going to have a leg up. Give me the rim shot.
Give it.
Yes.
Solid. Yeah, she may win. I think she may get $400 million or something like that. And by the way, here's the thing. To me, you have to look at the track record of both the criminals.
Right.
If one guy's a long rap sheet, that's the guilty one.
Right.
His last wife he was with for 70
Forever.
Years,
yeah.
And then we with her today, except for she died.
Right.
Because Barry Bonds wouldn't use one of those pink bats.
Bobby!
If Barry'd only used the pink bat, she'd still be alive today singing backup for Wings. Point is it must be her fault because he has a track record of endless relationships.
You're saying you did the math and it's Heather Mills' fault.
Yes, that's right.
Brian, what's this song here?
Yeah, what is this song?
She's leaving home.
Nicely done, sir.
Nicely.
Very good.
Yeah. I like it anyway.
You could have taken the easy road and done what's the one everyone's doing.
I heard on the news this morning someone said we can work it out.
Right, you didn't do that.
Mm-mm.
You could have done that, but you're better than that.
Better song, yeah.
On American Idol last night, Catherine McPhee had her big moment. She sang Simon's pick for her, which was Somewhere Over the Rainbow, and he loved it. Let's hear some of that.
The rainbow.
I'm very happy for you tonight because I think it proves the point, as I said last week, that you don't need to layer too much. You have a very, very special talent. And I'm not just saying this because I chose the song, but that was the single best performance of the competition today.
She makes me want to kill myself.
Why?
First off, the camera pulls up so tight on her that it's as if you've pressed your face against hers, and I cannot detect a pore on her skin.
Feel same.
She's 20, 21. You're supposed to have zits. You forget. People think, oh, you have zits when you're in junior high, 14, 15. Oh, no. I had some nice zits going at 19, 20, 21. No problem. Yeah. So, totally unflawed.
Yeah.
I mean, totally unflawed in skin. It does not own pores. Then you never detect a bead of sweat and a twitch, a quiver, nothing on her. She's incredibly poised.
Yeah.
Then her mouth opens up wide like a hippo yawning, and the top of her teeth are wider than the front.
Yeah.
She doesn't own a cavity, this one.
No, I feel the same way.
Her tongue is like a velvet carpet.
I've had this conversation with my friends. I want to like her more, but I feel like she hasn't suffered ever. She hasn't even had a pimple. How can she really evoke?
And then they cut to her doting father.
Crying.
In the waterworks.
Parents still married.
Parents still married and bawling out in there. And I don't mean crying. I mean physically having intercourse. Now, crying away in the audience. And I think, oh my God, I'm waiting for her head to pop off in a big spring just to be there. She's a fembot.
Yeah.
It's really. She's not nervous.
She has no soul.
Could she get a split end or a zit or something?
No, but I can't get behind her.
Jesus.
Well, and also then they said, I caught the last 4 minutes or so of the show. Cal said that Elliot is going to be sent home.
Well,
yeah,
he basically said, your mother can be proud. You did a good job.
So it'll be her, the girl, versus the white haired buffoon who dances about like a jag off every
Taylor
day.
Hicks.
So the girl's going to win then for sure.
Well, I'll tell you what. Mm. Simon Cowell was on your best friend Jay Leno's show on Monday night, and he predicted Taylor Hicks would win.
Mm. So. Yeah, Taylor did make a good showing in his third song. Hold on a second. Juan?
Yeah.
You recycle human waste?
It's a wastewater treatment plant.
Uh-huh.
And, once we get done with it, we sun dry it, and it's sold as fertilizer, but while it's in the process, we get methane out of it, which runs boilers and
you do tap equipment. You do tap the human waste then already.
Huh.
Yeah.
So it's not a new idea.
And do you ever do something like this? Like I don't know, eat a couple of glass beads or something, and then wait at the treatment plant to see if yours passes by the conveyor belt. That's what I would do.
We haven't done that yet.
I would look for mine. I would figure out a way to do it. I would go Duke through an extruder that was star shaped or something, and I would find my own fecal matter if I worked there.
No, but the guys that run the crew, the sewer line crew. They find watches and jewelry down the sewer line, so it's a money-making process.
That's a keeper. Wife's anniversary's coming up. Got her this tennis bracelet. All right. Good luck to you, Juan.
All righty.
And Juan, let me ask you this. Growing up, you know, remember back when you were 11 or 12, you wanted to be an astronaut or a pirate or something? Where was working at the sewage plant on the list? Just below Major League Baseball player?
Speaking of which, one of the guys that runs a honey dipper truck used to be a professional baseball player.
Oh.
And when I first met him, I asked him the same question.
How the mighty have fallen. Yeah, the Honey Dipper truck is the tank that drives around filled with fecal matter. And you just drop the hose right into the commode over at the Port-A-San and suck that thing dry. I always thought one of the greatest gags you could ever do, you do it if you had a girlfriend that dumped you. You do it when you needed payback on a neighbor or something. If you knew someone that drove one of those trucks and he made the rounds, he filled the tank up, then you went over to your horrible neighbor's house or the girlfriend that left you on the altar or whatever it was, crack the sunroof open on her car, all the windows would be rolled up, and just topped it off. You did not stop until you were putting your initials in the very top and smoothing it over with a metal trowel, like Grauman's Chinese. Hey,
it's
look
a nice
how
finishing touch. I didn't
John Wayne
that.
Had a huge foot. Look at that. That's how you would finish it off, trowel smooth with that. That's how you fit. Now, what could you do with that automobile at that point? Would you open the door? What would you do?
It's a conundrum.
Crap aquarium. Thank you.
Thank you.
The more you know.
Now, thank you. Yes. This is something that actually could be an important public service announcement. Mm-hmm. Recently, it was National Orgasm Day. Mm. Pamela Anderson weighed in on orgasm, saying, quote, "For your best orgasm ever, go vegetarian." The folks at PETA agree, saying that meat clogs arteries, not just the heart, but other vital organs.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I found a carrot works really well.
All right.
Bill the gay board up.
Pre-op, board up, Bill.
Working blue.
So
or orange,
sad.
Is the case.
Yeah. All right.
Okay, he won the first season of Survivor, and yesterday Richard Hatch won a 4-year prison stint. Mm-hmm. For failing to pay taxes on his $1 million winnings from the show and other earnings. Mm. Hatch maintained all along that he thought the show's producers would cover the taxes.
Sure.
And that's
sure that never came up.
Yeah, and his defense attorneys portrayed Hatch as a bit of a bumbling bookkeeper who was just overwhelmed by sudden fame.
Yeah.
But 4 years, the judge kind of threw the book at him.
Yeah, well, I got to say, when someone gives you $1 million and you have to take $425K out of that million and hand it over to Uncle Sam so he can waste it on nothing, that's rough. I mean, we all just have the money taken out as it comes. It's a slow death, but it's much more easier to tolerate. Imagine having $1 million cash in and then having to gather up $400K and then some and just hand it over to somebody who earned nothing, who deserves nothing. Thank you. The more you know.
Okay, we talked about it a little earlier, but the Da Vinci Code had a press screening last night at the Cannes Film Festival, and critics are calling it a bomb.
Don't care. I'm seeing it anyway.
I am, too.
They said at the Cannes Film Festival, usually people give standing ovations at the end of the picture. Mm-hmm. I read that people hissed.
Well,
and made catcalls.
Here's what happened. It's almost 2.5 hours long, so audiences, and these were critics, just critics in the audience, were reportedly bored, and worse, they laughed at an especially melodramatic Tom Hanks moment that wasn't supposed to be funny.
Yeah.
According to one reviewer from the Boston Herald, quote, "It's not suspenseful, it's not romantic, it's certainly not fun." Opens worldwide this weekend.
Mm.
But you'll be there.
Yes, I will.
I'm Teresa Strasser, and that is the news.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one sports. Do it, Dave.
Boy, oh boy, what a game last night in the Valley of the Suns. Between the Clippers and the Suns.
Mm-hmm.
It was a double overtime gem. You didn't see this game, Ace.
No.
It was on into the very late hours for people who have to wake up at the hour that we're expected to be.
I was with the men watching American Idol, Dave. Sorry, lady. Huh?
I don't think you want to.
We were
that.
Watching someone named Catherine McPhee sing Over the Rainbow, little yes. Judy Garland song. Perhaps you remember it.
All right, Macho Man. Listen, here's what happened in the game since you missed it. The Clippers were way down thanks to the play of guys like Sean Marion, who ended up with 36 points, 20 rebounds for the Suns. But Elton Brand and Sam Cassell and company, they brought them roaring back. They tied the game, sent it to overtime. First overtime ended. Looked like the Clippers were going to win. They were up 3. And Rajah Bell for the Suns hit a 3. Forced the second overtime. Suns win it. 125, 118. The good news is tomorrow night, the two teams get it on again in L.A., 7:30, Staples Center. Be there.
They say backbreaker, but I'd like to change that out with hymen breaker.
Worse.
That'd be good. Yeah, painful. Worse. Yeah.
I can tell you.
Hymen breaker. Oh, that was a hymen breaker for the Clippers. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. When he
Shaq
drained
Fu.
That three.
Yeah, Shaq you're never Fu. The same again after a hymen breaker.
No, never get that hymen back.
Not anymore. You can get it rejuvenated.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dave.
I can set
I'll
you
make
up
a
with
note
a doctor.
Of that.
Yeah.
Now, on to Shaq Fu. He and his fancy new pals. In Miami, they're moving on to the Eastern Conference Finals. They beat Jersey last night to end that series. Now on to the national pastime.
Mm-hmm.
As always, good news, and there's bad news. Mm-hmm. The teams, if you hear your name called out here, it's like you're a kid listening to the radio to hear if your school day got snowed out because of the storm, you know?
Yeah.
Here's the good news.
Yeah, we're both from California.
Yeah, we have.
San Francisco Giants.
We have smog days.
Halos. Athletics. Arizona Snakes. Congratulations to you all. Especially the Snakes. They're in first place now. Now for the bad news. If you hear your name called, I'm going to need you to stick around after class.
Okay.
Dodgers, Padres, Mariners. Now, the big news from baseball, though, yesterday was Barry Bonds hit no home run, but he was beamed in Houston. They're playing down in Houston. Russ Springer, the relief pitcher, beamed him. The crowd went wild. It's really gotten to a point now where I am right on the cusp of feeling bad for Barry Bonds. It's almost gotten sad, but now it looks like Springer's going to get suspended or fined or whatever for hitting Bonds. In his defense, it's virtually impossible to throw the ball in his direction without hitting him because of his artificially induced gigantism with that giant head and everything.
Yeah, crowds of play. Also, if I was holding a baseball or potato or beanbag or anything, and I was standing on a mound of dirt, and 60 feet away, there was a person standing there, or could be an old person in a wheelchair, the kind that you work by blowing into a straw, and there were 60,000 people that were going to go nuts. If I hit the old person in a wheelchair with the potato, it would come sailing right at their head, and then I would take a bow. Absolutely.
Blowing kisses.
Thank you. Doing that matador bow. So Thank you.
Mother Teresa comes up to the plate. You're going to bean her.
Mother Teresa in a wheelchair in just a diaper could be sitting at home plate. I could be holding a raw potato, and I would fire that thing right at her head if I knew the 60-something thousand people would go nuts when it hit her in the forehead.
I'll tell you what I wasn't
cheering
for. And
every road pitcher, by the way, should be listening to this, because you will be a hometown hero just by throwing the ball at Bonds. Oh, you'll get tossed out of the game. Who cares?
Right. I like that. Now, I say I was not cheered, though. In Little League, I was pitching, and first three innings, perfect game.
Hold on, how can you pitch from right field?
You creep, you. This thing's a rifle.
Did you hear this?
Attached to my left shoulder.
Did you hear this a lot? A walk's as good as a hit, baby.
Well, I was perfect through three.
You heard lean into this one a few times, too.
Go ahead. That was a good story.
Well, listen, no, I'm happy about it. I've got a head start on next week's jerk report already.
Oh, no, Dave, come on.
Now, fourth inning starts, I load the bases full. Then the only girl in the league comes to the plate. The only girl in the entire Little League.
Oh, no.
First pitch, plunked her.
Wow.
Not on purpose, you understand?
Sure.
I just hit her right in the back.
Did you hurt her?
No one cheered that day.
That hymen wasn't going to bust itself.
Was she hurt? Was she okay?
Who cares?
Yeah.
Nah, she was fine.
Yeah. She could be president.
Wait a second. You catch one of my fastballs. You better believe.
She's still
16 miles an hour.
Still in the hospital. That's right.
Lastly, Stanley Cup playoffs tonight up in Edmonton. The local crowd ought to be in a real lather because the last game, which was down in San Jose, the San Jose Sharks fans booed the Canadian national anthem. That should be fun to see how that plays out. But the bigger story is, if the Sharks don't win, they're out. That means Chichu's out. Oh. That means no more Chichu Tamu songs.
Oh, good dear news, Lord, no.
Good news for Carole, especially for his poor wife, Lynette, who apparently has had it. But on the other hand, perhaps I can induce labor.
With a Chichu song?
Perhaps a baseball. Why don't you just
baseball,
throw at her while she crowds the plate?
I have a better idea. Here's my latest offense.
But you don't know.
Oh, no.
Both their hockey skills amaze me. The Police.
Yeah.
Choosing one would drive me crazy. Chee choo choo choo, te moo moo moo, is all I want to say to you. Chee choo choo choo, te moo moo moo, sharks and ducks will pull it through. Chee choo choo choo, te moo moo moo, my favorite names belong to you. Chee choo choo choo, te moo te moo.
Let me ask you.
Wait for it, wait for it.
I'm waiting.
Chee choo.
Damashek's number one sports.
Yes, Adam.
Dave, your dad's a physician, is he not?
Right.
He must have had plans for you.
Big plans.
Most doctors do. I'm just saying.
You had a head start in life.
I'm a songsmith.
You were an A student in high school. If you just woke up and you're in a recording studio, you had no idea what the last 10 years. You'd forgotten all about the last, and you just woke up and you're standing there going, choo, 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 te moo. Would you have any idea? Would you be able to put it in any kind of context?
Well, I will tell you this. I've never been more ashamed.
Even when you hit the girl when you were pitching in Little League.
Nope, this trumps that. I didn't do it again. That's the difference.
What if you
hit the girl once and only once? This is like number six or seven.
What if you went right from the pitcher's mound just after beating the girl while she was limping to first base, right to the recording studio
then
where you laid down Temu and Chicho?
Now there's a history of pathetic behavior.
All right, we will take ourselves a little break. Our Indian intern, Doug, may or may not do his Hollywood report. I don't see him.
He's running late.
He's running a little bit late. If not, don't worry. We'll do one of our famous reenactments, torn from the pages of the news. We'll take a quick break. Be right back after this.
The Adam Carolla Show. By far, this is the best part of your day.
All right, Ozzy. How about Antonio Banderas?
Antonio Banderas.
Nice. How about Roberto Clemente?
Roberto Clemente.
Nice, nice. Geraldo Rivera.
Geraldo Rivera.
Oh, yeah. Said with gusto.
Stick around. We'll be right back with more of the Adam Carolla Show.
Adam, you crazy son of a bitch. Hey, I went to North Hollywood High, too. You rock, dude.
I was
going to
say, what about Bob? Just for the black people who've never had any white names.
Hey, I got a great name for your little girl. Blue Velour Lounge Chair.
Sweet. It'll be taken under consideration. Business to get to. First, somebody from Spain. We have a caller. Had a caller yesterday from Spain. He listens on the internet. He chimed in with a Chichu Temu song.
Eugene did.
Eugene from Spain. I guess we have it. Should we hear it?
Yeah. Oh, Spanish flavor to it.
Nice.
Castanets.
Chichuleo, chichuleo, porque mi vida yo la prefiero vivir así. Chichuleo, chichuleo, porque mi vida yo la prefiero vivir así. Chichuleo, chichuleo, porque mi vida yo la prefiero vivir así.
You know, whenever they translate a song, like you go, what is the guy talking about? They go, the young man is singing about a love that, don't do the singing part. We get that part. We understand the part where he's singing. Just say, here's what he's talking about. He sings about his unrequited love. I know. I can hear the singing. That's the one part I don't need translated. It's the language part. Well, it was nice. It's caught on. It's now a global phenomenon.
The world over.
Yes.
Yes. The only part of it I don't appreciate is that everybody who comes up with a song makes one better than anything I've come up with.
Yeah,
that
hurts
my feelings.
That was solid. Murray, our crazy caller. Murray?
Oh, yeah.
Murray, I hear you stopped by the station earlier.
Yes.
What did you expect to find when you came by?
Well, I my style drove me in unexpectedly and quite by surprise screeched me in. And I was under a fusion bubble for my lifestyle for support. Yes.
We share the road with Murray, by the way. Why is it
drugs.
Crazy people can find everybody? That's an interesting thing. Yeah, I mean, they can't find their fly or the front door or two brain cells to rub together. But if you're a celebrity, they'll find you.
Well, how did he do the math? That's a good question. How did he figure out where we are?
Yes.
Get over here.
Bruskett can barely make it to the studio every morning. How's it that Crazy Murray finds the studio?
Well, the phone company disconnected my phone.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's what happened.
I had no intention
to do it so quick.
How did you drive to the studio?
I wanted you to weave a net here to hang yourself for later.
Yeah, Adam.
Me too.
Sorry. I don't picture Murray driving. I picture him being chased by a guy with a butterfly net, and that's how he gets everywhere. He sits by the front door. Hey, I got to go out and buy a pack of smokes. You want to chase me down a liquor store?
Just dumb lucky wound up at our front door this morning.
Yeah. I think he's being chased by personal demons.
Oh. Murray?
Yeah. So Sour Talk, this got to be said. Sour Talk is pro-emotionally clear for carrying more money.
I agree.
What kind of, I don't think anyone could argue with that. What kind of car do you drive?
So that's what I learned. I know you asked me, well, what's the main point of everything going on or coming on? That's the point. We'll go from Pittsburgh to Valley Forge.
Mm-hmm.
What Murray. You just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard.
I want to conduct an experiment, Murray.
Yeah, I'm afraid you won't pass the Westinghouse.
Again with the Westinghouse.
Filter.
Yes, okay. Here's what I would like.
Yeah.
I would like you to tell me what kind of automobile you own. If you cannot tell me that, I'm going to hang up.
A Ford Escort.
Ah! Oh. You see? Here's my theory, and this is why we need to be tougher on folks that are mentally impaired. Mm-hmm. Not easier on them. You can cut through their fog if you really get direct, and then there's some threat behind it.
Right.
I'll take away your hard candy. I'll hang up on you. Whatever it is, he's all over the map. But if you really focus and you get his attention, I think you can get answers. All right, so, Murray.
Yeah, that may be significant later.
Okay.
Oh.
That's going to factor into
the
our
Ford
equation.
Escort.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact you want to, I walked over.
And what do you, I see. And what do you do to pay your bills? Do you have assistance from the government?
For doing my left wing Lola, they had to cover up. They gave me the hedge money.
Give him a rim shot on that one.
That was good stuff. All right, Murray.
Yeah.
Well, here's the thing. I would like our relationship to be maintained via the telephone.
Yeah. That's all. But forget the hanging business. You mm-hmm. do, right. you're limelight on the air.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right. Hang on there, Murray.
Yeah. Oh, and you got my opinion from the meeting part was the contract.
Right.
And they really gave me. Yeah, I was trying to improve my lifestyle, legacy, quality,
right.
promotions by bubble effusion. No. The answer came in from such a bounce here at the contract.
He told you.
Murray.
Otherwise, I'm offensive.
Murray.
Yeah.
I want to know, do you have a pet that could tell you to kill me? Just want to make sure you don't have any pets.
That's a good question.
No.
Good.
You're on the left end of Merrill Lynch.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, definitely.
Right. That's good. That's right.
To the feds.
All right, good.
Yeah.
Never get any pets.
No.
Okay. All right. We need to take ourselves a break. Do you have a Chi Chu Temu song before we go to break?
Oh, yes. Oh, I do. Oh, okay.
Let's hear it.
So when I saw it was Corolla rather than Coppola, I went over to Ed Powers buying the Potter Corrigan Ranch.
Yeah, that doesn't rhyme with Tama.
Yeah, but that's the big one here to go hatchet against the feds.
All
with
right.
Musburger. Hey, Pollard Town!
All right. Hang on. I think we should call him. I don't know why it just popped in my head, but I was thinking Rain Man, but he's more than that. He's like Hail Man.
Yeah.
He's golf ball size Hail Man. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back after this.
You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show, where everyone is entitled to Adam's opinion.
The guys that do the healing and the preaching have the most exotic hair. That, to me, is a strike. When I see someone with crazy hair, I think crazy. If they're talking about the Lord and they have crazy hair, now we're out.
Stick around. We'll be right back with more of The Adam Carolla Show.
Aloha, this is Laird Hamilton. You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show.
Ah, Laird. I'll see you in my dreams, sweet surfer man. Well, that's it. Sorry, we got pushed back. We ran out of show. I want to thank Pat O'Brien. P.O.B. Or B.F.D. as his ex-wife knows him. From The Insider. Should I mention Christine Dolce or
not?
Talk about sagely advice. Sure, she's easy on the eyes, but if you want to know how to navigate the club scene, you listen to Christine's drunken ramblings. Kane, See No Evil in theaters this coming Friday. Tomorrow, Def Rat Guy in studio. Until next time, this is Adam Carolla saying mahalo.